Good morning and welcome to the eighth meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. May I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. And I'd like to extend apologies from Miles Briggs, who's unable to join us today. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item four in private. Are members agreed? Are all agreed? The next item on our agenda is to take evidence from two panels of witnesses as part of our Community Planning Inquiry post-legislative scrutiny of the Community Empowerment Act 2015. This is our second session in this inquiry. The inquiry is looking at the impact of the Community Empowerment Act 2015 on community planning and how community planning partnerships respond to significant events such as the COVID-19 pandemic and the current cost of living crisis. These partnerships are a crucial part of ensuring that communities receive the support and services that they need now more than ever. They bring organisations together to coordinate their activities and to listen and learn from each other. Today we'll be hearing from a number of national and regional organisations involved in community planning, and we're joined in the room on our first panel of witnesses by Mark McAteer, who's the Director of Strategic Planning, Performance and Communications, and Stephen Wood, who's the Head of Service Delivery North of Scotland, from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and Pauline Smith, who's the Chief Executive Director at Development Trust Association Scotland. And online, we're joined by Carolyn Warburton, who is the Destination Development Director at Visit Scotland, and Valerie Arbuckle, who's the National Partnership Development Manager at Police Scotland. And I welcome the witnesses to the meeting. We'll try to direct our questions to a specific witness where possible, but if you would like to come in, please indicate this to the clerks and Caroline and Valerie, as you can do this by typing an R in the chat function. There's no need to manually turn your microphones on and off, as we'll be doing that automatically for you. Each member will be exploring a particular theme, and Annie Wells, who's joining us online, will be starting our discussion this morning by asking you some questions about the challenges that communities face. Annie.
Good morning, convener, and good morning, panel. I've just got a couple of questions. The first one is, we've heard that inequalities are a moving target and that a lot has changed in the last 8 years. What is your organisation's role as a community planning partner in helping tackle those inequalities? And I think, first of all, could I go to Mark, please?
Yeah, thank you for the question. I suppose, as a statutory community planning partner, you know, our role is to support CPPs and through them communities across a whole range of outcomes. While our focus is primarily around community safety, as you can imagine, being the nature of an emergency service, we're also involved in a wide variety of work around about prevention, not just in terms of fire, but other aspects that lead to inequality within communities. So that probably takes us into a wide range of areas where we work in support of partnerships. We tend not to be the lead partner, but we tend to play a part in working with others. So, for example, in Highlands at the moment, we're running a partnership with Home Energy Scotland, where we're looking to see where can we, because we're one of the successful organisations at getting into people's homes and kind of helping and supporting with them, how can we work with that partnership and through the CPP to ensure that people have got good access to energy efficiency information, things like that. So that's typically the role that we play out with the pure safety elements. It's how do we broker a relationship between communities and others and to then through that help them address some of the issues of inequality. We're also involved in some employability and employment partnership working on a similar basis. And very often we're a host organisation, particularly for young people, to help them either find a place in the workplace or to pick up some skills as part of their portfolio construction. And that's, again, a very important role for us because it's typically targeted at children who, or young people rather, who are finding it difficult to get into the workplace. And as you can imagine, an attractive organisation to a lot of young people, they find the prospect of coming and working with us and picking up transferable skills that can then help them back into the workplace is something that's very attractive. So that's the kind of the breadth of spectrum that we tend to be involved in.
Anybody else? I don't know if anyone else wants
So I'm here, although we're not a strategic partner of the community planning, we are supporting development trusts across the whole of Scotland. So we have about 350 plus members, and the challenges that they're facing really at the moment, it's a bit like what Mark said, you know, like the challenges are about employability, youth training, you know, supporting the most vulnerable people in the communities. As community anchors, you know, they're there for the long term, and they need to overcome the challenges for all of the people in their communities. I would also say one of the challenges is that, I mean, you'll know yourself, you know, how many assets are getting let go from local authorities at the moment, and community anchors and development trusts are very much at the forefront of asset transfer. So they're trying to find how do they save the assets within their community, how would they run them. So there's a lot of challenges involved in there that I think community planning partnerships are aware of and that they can support.
Thanks for that, Pauline. And I believe Valerie and then Caroline would like to come in as well.
Hello, panel. Yes, Police Scotland are really keen to tackle inequalities, and one of the areas that we specifically see is the existence of a criminal record on someone exacerbates their ability to find work, etc. So we are doing everything we can within Police Scotland to try and tackle inequalities through diversion from prosecution and other alternatives within the community justice system. As a community planning partnership, we're very keen to develop any local diversion strategies and working alongside the community justice partnerships, particularly to try and effect this. So I suppose that it's a part of the tackling inequalities that people maybe not think about in relation to Police Scotland, but we really try to help with poverty. We've also got within our divisional teams through community planning links, more opportunities to divert people to food banks and help with fuel and food and other areas too. So there is an awful lot that Police Scotland are doing, not only on their own, but as part of the community planning, wider community planning structure. And an awful lot of this is really facilitated through our community planning partners too.
Thanks, Valerie. And Caroline?
Thank you and good morning, everybody. So Visit Scotland, so we're the national tourism organisation, so we're perhaps in a slightly different position in the fact that we are sector related. So our focus is on tourism and the visitor economy and how that can support communities. So we are led by the National Strategy for Economic Transformation as one of the economic development agencies, which is focused on a well-being economy. So communities and the impact that tourism can have on communities and with communities is very much part of what we're focused on. In terms of the challenges, we've seen the challenges, particularly in recent years, of COVID and the cost of living crisis. And within the Act, there's discussion around communities, but also communities of interest. And from our perspective, we do much of our work with the community of interest that is the business community and the tourism industry. Tourism touches every community in Scotland. There is no part of Scotland which isn't affected by the visitor economy in some levels. So I think that from our perspective, we feel that as a statutory partner, we have justification in being involved with community planning partnerships.
Thanks for that. Annie, do you have any more questions?
Yeah, just one sort of a follow-up question, because it's kind of been touched on from the panel in the last question. The 2015 Act places a duty on CPPs to tackle socio-economic inequalities. To what extent can CPPs help prevent inequalities rather than deal with the consequences of them? I think the first one, could I go to Valerie on this, because you sort of touched about sort of helping direct people to food banks and stuff like that, so I don't know if you can start, Valerie.
Yes, no trouble. I suppose the opportunity that we have to direct people to other sources is helped through the community planning, but it can be made more difficult too, because we've all got our own structures in place, we've all got our own objectives in place, and sometimes it's that decision between doing it on our own, maybe quickly, or doing it at a different pace through community planning. Or sometimes even quicker through community planning. It just depends where. It's all to do with the personality of the people involved and their ability to drive change. But there's definitely opportunities that we have to make that tackling of inequalities more grassroots within with our frontline officers. And because one of the comments that's regularly made is that our officers are the eyes and ears of the community, because we get into people's houses when they're in a crisis situation. So there's an awful lot that we can do to try and effect change and positive change by referring people to other organisations who can provide assistance and help.
And Stephen, you wanted to come in.
Thank you. Yes, just building on what Valerie said there about grassroots, I think whilst we are a national service, we are structured in such a way that we have a reach into all the communities. And I think we've heard that there's differences across all the partners and how we, you know, the issues that we face. So we've been able to empower our staff at a local level, that there's really a push that the initiatives and the work that we do comes from the grassroots upwards, up towards us. So, you know, we have stations in all the communities, and the crews in there are really working hard at the moment to listen, you know, deal with the local issues. I think there's some great work going on, which is really worth noting. We opened the stations as warm spaces in the lead up to Christmas there. I think we badged up as a brew with the crew, and that's evolved now. We've got coffee with the cops, Pepsi with the paramedics, and it's just about bringing in partners, bringing in the community. In some places it works and there's a real uptake and there's a real conversation. In some places there's not, but it just demonstrates the differences across the country and the different approach we need to take in order to tackle the problems.
Pepsi with the paramedics.
I think we're stretching it a wee bit.
I know. Pauline, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, I was just going to add, I mean, the social and economic disadvantage within communities has been done by communities for, 40-odd years, maybe longer, you know. So I suppose my point would be that to be able to tackle the disadvantage, the more money you get directly within the local communities, the better. You know, the more local it is, the more... the more change can happen, the more direction can be taken by local people, more employment can be created, training, etc. And also, you know, the warm spots, etc. They've been created through communities throughout the pandemic, and they're still continuing. So they're adapting to whatever their local community needs. So I would say just more local and more directed within the local community areas.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to move on to the next theme, which is about community empowerment, fittingly. And that theme is going to be led by Mark Griffin.
Yep. Thanks, Kimina. I'll probably come to Stephen first at End Valley just to ask, how is participation with communities then affecting how your organisation works with community plan partnerships? And really, have you got a view as to whether that's changed in the 8 years since the Act has passed, or are you just continuing as you were?
Thank you. I think we've learnt as an organisation to listen much more. You know, our role has expanded. Our understanding of the contribution we can make has really expanded. The information comes to us in a grassroots level. We have lots of staff embedded in the community, as well as the local crew who, you know, they're part of the on-call crew, are part of the community. So there's definitely a route into us and through us, both within our internal structures and into planning partnerships. And I think there's a general awareness over the last 8 years. Our prevention work in the past was always preceded by the word fire. But I think we're now far wider than that. We understand the causes of some of the issues that we face as a service, and we've been able to widen that out and look to tackle the source of some of these issues. And I think with partners, there's a real shared understanding there that you know, it might conclude in a fire at some point, but the solution to that is far before that point. So I think our approach as a national service has matured and changed over the last 8 years. I think the links with partners and done through the community planning partnership has greatly strengthened. So I think we've seen a real change.
Has that been because of the reorganisation to a national service, or explicitly because of the Community Empowerment Act?
I think it's just a natural evolution. I think there would be pockets of it pre-national service. I think we've been able to harness that as a national service, p- put some real national direction behind it and a cultural change within the service. So I suppose we've smoothed that out and established a real direction as a service.
If I could maybe just give in the support of that, I suppose if I would use three words to describe deepened, broadened and localised, I think it kind of sums up our approach since the Act. In the early days of the service, you know, post-2013, when ourselves and Police Scotland were created, first couple of years was very much establishing the organisation, as you can imagine, going through such a major transformation. But from that point onwards, it was very much about how do we embed ourselves further in community planning. And I think across the country, when I look at the 32 CPPs, we've certainly deepened the relationships we have with our partners. And it takes us into such a wide array of areas, as Stephen's kind of alluding to. I mean, it can range from things like drug and alcohol partnerships, where we are very much part of the how do we get in and work and support highly vulnerable people, people coming out of perhaps the prison service into the community. We're one of the people that they will encounter and meet as part of a home fire safety visit, but it's really to touch base, build relationships and work with them right through to, say, things like victim support safety, where, again, people who have been a victim of crime, we're part of the partnership that will look to support them. So over the years, we've certainly deepened and broadened the range of partnerships. But at the same time, an important message, I think, as Stephen said, is from the corporate out has been, this is about localism. This is about how you as crews within an area work with your community, so you guide us as much as we will guide you in all of this. And that kind of localisation of it has been, I think, probably the most successful element of our internal approach to this. Allow the local people in the local areas to really, within those parameters, go and work with their community, their partners, in ways that work in their area. Not what does it look like from an HQ perspective, but rather what does it look like in Wick? What does it look like in Dumfries? And then build it up, as Stephen was saying. That's been very much driven through the organisation, and that kind of local or organic element of community planning, I think, very much encapsulates what we now do on a day-to-day basis.
Thanks. I don't know, Valerie, if you've got any views on how participation with communities changed since the Act was introduced.
I think first thing to point out is that, and probably all organisations to a degree have this, that there's a kind of requirement or an expectation that we consult with the public on a regular basis. And Police Scotland have the police, Your Police Survey, which has been running now for several years and has gathered a lot of information from members of the public about what they think of the police service. And we also have a customer satisfaction survey for people who have had contact with us as a single organisation. However, that also then extends into the community planning partnerships, who also seek to engage with members of the public to get information about how they're doing it. And that can risk potentially a bit of fatigue from the survey, fatigue from members of the public, as they are expected to regularly give a view about. One of the things I always think is that it's actually not bad if somebody doesn't have a view about the police, because I would hope that the majority of citizens in Scotland hopefully don't need our service and are living a peaceful, happy life in their own community without any problems. But for those people who do have an issue, we would want to obviously understand and work, understand how that affects them. And in relation to, you know, examples when we have taken that to empower them, we are regularly working with different communities across Scotland. I know that one of the previous sessions you did, we were speaking about the work that was happening in Wallacetown, and I was one of the people who were out for Police Scotland doing the door-to-doors in Wallacetown. We're also doing some work specifically in Wick to try and kind of get people from that community, which is they describe as an island on the mainland. What do those people think of the service? And not only our service, but it's the wider service that's being made available to them. We're doing work in Perth as well in relation to communities to try and understand what their needs are and their wants are. And an awful lot of the time what we find is that we're a connecting organisation because of our staff that are in the different areas. And I suppose sometimes the uniform helps. It encourages people to kind of come together because maybe a police officer's telling you, but it's a suggestion, let's come together and talk. And it really does help to kind of bring together some members of the other agencies who are working to work together. And through that work together, it does definitely help empower the communities, because the members of the public then
an opportunity to be heard, because across all agencies, there's an impetus really to try and encourage customer participation, if you will, in order to make sure that we're designing services. And the other thing is that Police Scotland have back in, I think it was around 2020-2021, introduced, we've got our own design team, which follows the Scottish design principles and tries to encourage participation and empowerment about how we create new services, but a lot of the services we're creating aren't just for us, they extend to other partners within community planning.
To hear that Police Scotland's got a design team. I love that. Caroline, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, so Visit Scotland in 2003, we were not statutory partners at that point, so we've been brought in since 2015. And the degree to which the Act has changed how we work with communities, I think it has changed it quite significantly, because as a result, we've been engaged with, certainly initially, all of the community planning partnerships. So we've been brought into the conversation around communities and how our remit and our roles and responsibilities can help contribute towards the outcomes at that local level. A couple of examples. So obviously during COVID, there were quite a number of issues around visitor management. So in places, too many people visiting the countryside and certain towns and villages. And it was through our links with the community that we were able to be sensitive to how the tourism industry was responding to that, but also the key messages that we were able to do and provide that partnership approach, both at a national level, but also at a local level as well. And directly through the community planning partnerships, a couple of examples. So in East Lothian, we are part of the Connected Economy Group that was looking at recovery. And similarly, through West Lothian Community Planning Partnership, they had a short life, a cost of living working group, emergency working group. And again, we were part of that conversation, so we can ensure that the work that we're doing is contributing in a small or a large way to tackling inequalities in communities as well.
Thank you for that. And Pauline, did you want to come in?
From a slightly different angle, as not being a statutory partner, but I have lots of stories of development trusts or communities working with police and fire over the years. I suppose when it comes to empowerment through community planning structures, a lot of that sometimes happens direct to the police and to the fire brigades, actually. So it's not necessarily always through the community planning structures that we hear about it or how it happens in communities. Sometimes happens organically with the police and the fire being proactive with that. Now, I could be wrong, that could be coming through the community planning partnership structures. But I suppose from a community side of being empowered through the community planning, yes, it's improved. I think we have to acknowledge that it's different across across Scotland. I'm sure you've heard that many times. Different regions work in different ways. But I would say, that there certainly needs to be, what we've heard from our members, is there needs to be more emphasis on communities around those tables. So TSIs, for instance, are represented within there, but actually from a community anchor or other community organisations, they should be around the table as well. So that still needs to be worked on. It's a work in progress, I think. But yes, things have moved on, definitely, since the Empowerment Act, but still lots more to do, I would say.
Thanks for that. Mark, do you have any more questions?
Yep. Maybe start with you, Pauline. Just wonder how your organisation, or perhaps more appropriately, how your membership organisations are ensuring all voices are being heard. And I'm thinking about particular communities of interest or identity across the whole spectrum. How are those sometimes minority groups getting their voices heard at community planning partnership level, and what your membership organisations are doing to facilitate that?
I suppose at the heart of any development trust is it's for the whole community. It's not just a community of interest, it's for the full community. So working with young people, elderly, adults, people with disabilities, additional needs, etc. So they proactively do that through their community action plans, etc. So they're actively engaging the community at all levels of the work. So there'll be very rare that you'll find a development trust or a community anchor organisation that does one type of service, whether it's for whichever demographic within the community. community. So they're constantly engaging the community within that. And that's why, from a community planning perspective, you know, the voice of those community anchor organisations needs to be listened to, you know, like, and it's a very, very strong voice of what's at the heart of their communities. So I would say they do it on a day-to-day basis of engaging the community on the wide section of that.
Thanks, Polly. Valerie, I don't know if you've got any experience in Police Scotland and how Police Scotland are engaging with particular minority communities of interest or identity and supporting them getting their voices heard.
I think that there's obviously an awful lot of this is governed by legislation, and one of the aspects that we see day and daily in relation to minority groups would be hate crime. So it's very much to the fore for our organisation and feeds into an awful lot of things that we do, trying to make reporting of hate crime, for example, more accessible. However, that insight we have into the problems that are affecting local communities, we can then take that to local community planning partnerships, because we can see what the issues are within local communities and what the problems in relation to seldom heard voices, or as I like to describe them sometimes, seldom listened to voices. But it helps us understand a bit more about what's happening in the ground within local areas, and our representatives and community planning partnerships can take that straight into the local community planning partnerships for discussion about what needs doing in order to help them live safe and happy, healthy lives within their own communities. Now, whether or not we could do more, I think probably, undoubtedly, we could do more. Our ability to engage when it's not a situation of a crime can be difficult, but we are really, across the country, we have local groups, local teams trying to encourage participation from a whole range of different types of organisations, from people with disabilities, minority groups from other new Scots coming to the country, etc. We've got an awful lot of involvement across the whole board about people from who are not the standard white Scottish, who are other impairments, etc. So we definitely have a key role to play in hearing those voices, but also then bringing those voices to community planning.
Thanks, Valerie. And final question, Kimira, maybe direct it to Caroline. Initially, you talked about sometimes a conflict between demand for tourism services and an impact on communities. And I just wondered what role Visit Scotland have in terms of giving communities a voice, and how services are designed, and how you manage sometimes the conflict between what communities want and what demand there is for tourism services, particularly when it comes to the impact on deprived or marginal communities. Because, you know, we've heard before, obviously, tourism has a great economic impact in Scotland, but some communities do feel the burden more than others, and wonder how you manage that.
Yeah, that's a big topic, but I'm happy to touch on it today. I think it's around balance, and it's around listening, and it's around collaboration. I think COVID has probably changed the way that we listen to communities, because we were the market had changed when previously we were focused on bringing people into the country, which we are now back looking to do. However, when people were not able to come into the country, it was very much a local market, and so local people were out and about. And we were listening to visitors, but we were also listening through the destination organisations that we work very closely with. So whether that's at a local authority level, or whether it's at a destination level, or whether it's at a local tourism association level, that network that we have of listening to what's happening on the ground really came to the fore. During COVID, as I say, in particular, there were particular communities that were struggling. And so we made sure that we were listening, whether that was either directly, we would reach out to them directly, or whether or not it was through those network of of associations and groups. So in terms of areas where there were arguably too many visitors at times, we could work directly with those communities, and we could either switch off or switch on our marketing, depending on how that worked. In terms of perhaps the less visible communities, in terms of their access to tourism and their access to having a holiday, the right to having a holiday, we've done a lot of work looking at accessible and inclusive tourism, and the particular projects recently around Scott Spirit, which was providing short breaks through care groups for low-income families and people with disabilities. So we recognise that we have a role to support everybody's right to have a break, and we do what we can through projects like Scott Spirit, try and enable that they can as well.
Thanks for that, Caroline. I don't know if anyone else wants to touch on how we're supporting marginalised or deprived communities. I know, Mark, you did last week.
Yeah, again, just to maybe add a couple of things. I suppose building on a point that Pauline made, that you know, through community planning, we've built relationships with a wide range of partners. And it's very much working with them. You then tend to work with the front line, if you like, the community themselves. So we're part of the fire enforcement, obviously, around about HMOs. So we work with the local authorities as they go about establishing the licensing arrangements for an HMO. So that gets us to work with the housing partners, and then you pick up intelligence and use that to reshape what we do. But you also then work with communities themselves. So, for example, in Glasgow, working the HMOs, you come across the new migrants to Scotland. You build relationships primarily for us around fire safety, but you're also then about making them feel welcome, included within the community, and you use the intelligence that comes from just those daily interactions with the community or the partners who work more closely with the community to get that insight. And what we've said to our local officers is, you know, shape your local plan around our strategic plan, which is a national plan for Scotland, but shape it around the LOIP and shape it around that intelligence that you pick up through that day-to-day interaction. And that's within their gift to then use the resources in their area to then make sure that they're hitting the right priorities for the community, not just us sitting in headquarters and campus lying who've got responsibilities for the strategic plan. And that's the balance that we're trying to work out through that. But it's very much about, as Stephen said, you empower the local staff to go build the relationships and then use the insight from that to shape what they do on a day-to-day basis, working directly with those communities. And it's really powerful when you see it happen. And we've given you some examples in our submission where you can see the effect that building those relationships really has for us.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Camilla.
Thanks, Mark. Yeah, that sounds like a really great process, quite a dynamic process of kind of discovering what's on the ground and then feeding that into your strategy. We're going to move on to the next theme, which is the role of the third sector and communities, and that's going to be led by Paul McLennan.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. Oliver Escobar last week from Edinburgh University mentioned about the need for community anchor organisations to be included as community partners, and obviously mentioned housing associations, development trusts. I'll probably come to yourself, first of all, Pauline, just in terms of that, around about to what extent is that happening now? I used to chair the Community Plan Partnership when I was in East Lothian, and we used to bring some of the development trusts in at occasional times. But to what extent is that happening across the country now, and what can be done around about that to try and improve that going forward?
Yeah. I think the key was they get invited in now and again. So what we would obviously like to see and what our development trusts are asking, as long as they're getting something out of it, you know, there's again, going back to it's different in different regions of Scotland. Do you know, like, that some of the members I've certainly got a bit fed up. Do you know, like, I've gone, well, I'm just getting going round the table just to get told what's happened. Now, I'm not saying that happens everywhere, but certainly there is a feeling, do you know, like, if it's going to be across the board, that everyone is there for a purpose, and what are you going to get out of it? So, all very busy people in Community Anchor and Development Trusts across, you know yourself. Yep. What I would say is it's not going to be piecemeal, do you know, like, it's going to be an actual seat at the table, an equal partnership at the table. So I mentioned TSIs before, and yes, there is a structure there that's been implemented, and it works, again, some regions better than others. However, if we're going to be serious about it, you know, if community anchors have got a lot to give within around this table, and I think our membership would like to certainly strongly say, bring us round the table to actually have an equal say and if not, you know, around that table, but also on the ground where it's worked really well with thematic groups, etc., from some of our membership. The operational side of things has worked well, you know, so as long as they have the power there, so it doesn't sit up here still, the decision-making powers still lie here where they're sitting around the table and they feel that they have the say, or they know they have the say in what happens within their local communities. So I would say it's improved in some areas, it's still got a way to go in some other areas. But that, you know, I suppose that's always going to be, be the way. But I think from our membership, definitely would welcome the chance to have more of a say at the table.
So in terms of that, I mean, I suppose, does that come back, obviously, right at the top level of the Community Planning Partnership Board itself, but the thematic ones are really important. And I'll come on in a wee second to Caroline, because Caroline, you mentioned, obviously, about East Lothian, which is my own area, and about the Connected Economy Group, and I'll come on to that in a little second. But is it involvement, is it needs to be at the top, but also the thematic level as well, because I think that they're as important, because you almost have the strategy, but where it's implemented.
Yeah, absolutely.
Implemented is a key thing.
Absolutely. Thematic ones, you know, the operational ones on the ground, that's where they sit, absolutely. Yeah. I think there could be more
and
of that encouraged.
How would you find that involvement then with local with Development Trust? Again, is that mixed across here? Or
mixed across the board, absolutely. Right. So, again, some regions, you've said that they feel listened to, that they're actually within the thematic groups are getting listened to. There's other ones, other regions that don't have thematic groups at all, you know, so it's very strategic and, you know, like the LOIPs and the local area plans rather than actually the community place-based plans. So I think there needs to be a commonality across the road. I mean, I would also, you know, every community is different, so it's not an easy job. Everyone realises that. But actually inviting the Development Trust, who realise it's difficult, want to be around that table to help make it better as well, you know, so that they have their communities can improve while they go.
Pauline, thanks for that. Caroline, I'll come across to yourself, because you mentioned around about the thematic group and the Connected Economy Group, particularly around about COVID, and I was part of that group when I was a councillor at the time and whatever, and that approach worked. I just wondered, do you find that approach across the rest of Scotland? Or again, like Pauline, do you find that's mixed across here? Because again, I know there needs to be some variability, if you like, in different parts of the country, but one of the key lessons for us is picking up what works and what could work in terms of that and sharing best practice. So, across the rest of Scotland, where do you find your involvement in the thematic groups and at the Community Planning Board level as well?
Yeah, it's very mixed, I think, is probably the way I would put it. I think there are some community planning partnerships that we are not particularly involved with, and that's really around the agenda that they or the priorities and the outcomes that they are striving for, and the degree to which tourism and the visitor economy is seen as part of that. I think in East Lothian, and I think actually during COVID, there were a number of subgroups across various CPPs that were looking at recovery, and tourism was part of that. On a perhaps a more formal basis, I can use Dundee as an example. So there's the Dundee Partnership, which is the CPP for the City of Dundee. Within that, there is a work and economy subgroup, or a board that they, as they call them, and then the Dundee Tourism Leadership Group feeds into that. So our involvement is through the Dundee Tourism Leadership Group, and a report goes up to the work and economy board on a regular basis, which then feeds up to the main board. So there are some where we have little involvement. There are some where we are part of subgroups on a permanent basis. There are others where Argyll and Isles, for example, Argyll and Bute, where we work with the local destination organisation, and twice a year we provide an update. So I think it's really, it goes back to, you know, what is relevant for that particular community. So I don't think there is a one size fits all approach, and we are there to respond to the degree to which visitor economy and tourism can help deliver the local outcome impact plans.
Thank you for that. Camina, we're just going to move on to the next question.
That's kind actually, sorry, Valerie wanted to come in.
Right. Yep.
Yes, thank you, Camina. I think that we had an event not long ago looking at mental health, and the people who were the most impacted speakers on that day were a third sector organisation, housing association, and a further education college. I think that sometimes the role that other organisations play that might not necessarily pop to the front of your head as being the most appropriate to invite actually have the most to give, and it's important that we open our ears to organisations who have a role to play within a community, and as you say, anchor organisations. The third sector interface teams are small, and we, as Police Scotland, we know how much work is involved in community planning, the administration, the preparation, the involvement. And it's a huge ask, I think, for third sector interfaces to participate at the level required. I think that they require some more support, because the people they are representing, the third sector that they're representing, are so crucial to the work that needs to be done, particularly in the world of earlier prevention, because of the inequalities that we're seeing. So I speak highly enough of the third sector. I think that they really need a place at that table in order to drive change, and also that we need to listen to voices from other organisations, anchor organisations, that are within the community planning structure. Whether that's at the executive level or the thematic level, that would be for the local teams to decide, but I definitely think third sector need to be involved in the executive level, and possibly a couple of organisations from the... as I say, you don't understand what another organisation has to give in their involvement until you start to kind of scratch the surface and try to understand a bit more about their role and the responsibilities that they see for themselves within a particular subject matter.
Valerie, thanks for that. That kind of takes me on to my next question, and I fully agree with the points that you're making, because the next question is really just talking about the role the CPP should have in delivering community wealth building aspirations. And you kind of touched on that, because it's almost these groups that hold the local community together to a certain extent, and to what role should CPPs play in helping deliver that. So you've kind of answered that question, and it was a great lead-in. But I'll probably come to Stephen and Mark around about that as well, about the thoughts around about that in your regard. And you kind of touched on it, Mark, around about the kind of work that you do, almost trying to embed the community, community wealth building that's kind of going on there. Yep. So I don't know if you want to touch on a wee bit and more, and again with Stephen, but just build
I'll
on that.
Maybe kick off and then hand over to Stephen. Just reflecting on the COVID period, I think one of the things that comes through quite strongly is that resilient communities were able to cope better with the impacts of COVID. There's not a real surprise in that. But what we also saw, I think, across the period in some of our more challenging communities is people and organisations stepping up. Now, whether that was because, you know, we were all, well, not all of us, but many people were home working, so we had time and capability and capacity that we could offer to communities through the pandemic. But it meant for organisations like us, there was a vast amount of resources to work locally with. It meant we would get intelligence about the most vulnerable people to make sure that we were there as partners to support them. Now, whether that was bringing shopping to people, bringing prescriptions, you name it, it gave us a capacity and a reach into communities that we'd perhaps struggled with in some areas before. How you build and sustain that out with a kind of pandemic is a massive challenge. And that goes back to, I think, Pauline's point. There are anchor organisations within communities that if we can get the relationships with them and through them into communities, you can build that resilience and use it for other purposes, not just an emergency response to a pandemic, but the day-to-day activities that then empower a community, and that helps address some of those other issues that we spoke about last week again as well. So I think it's a really important agenda for us.
Yeah.
Whether they should be at the CP table, whether they should be at the thematic level, I mean, I think, again, as Valerie was saying, that's really a matter for local decision-making. But if they're to be a statutory partner, I mean, I would certainly welcome them, because I think they've got something to offer that the rest of us will struggle to have. And Stephen, much closer to the local level of all of that than I am. But it's an incredibly powerful area, I think, that we've got some experience of through the pandemic to now reflect and build upon.
Yeah. Stephen, Pauline? Have anything to add to yourself, Stephen or Pauline?
Yeah, no, I agree wholeheartedly. I think the CPPs are an excellent forum, an excellent network. And our local practitioners, I don't think they really see what badge people are wearing. It's about what you can bring, what your solutions are, what your ideas are. So I fully support the more ideas that go into that, the better. And I think capturing that momentum, building on it, with the COVID period, it did force organisations to revisit, you know, a different set of challenges. I think we demonstrated through that some really resilient communities, and trying to use that network, continue to build it, and then continue to support the communities is key. Yeah.
It's a bit of a, I mean, community building, COVID, absolutely, but community wealth building, there is development trusts across our community anchors doing it across the country at the moment. I think, does it sit with CPP? I think there's definitely an element, probably does, because asset transfers, etc., sit within the local authorities, usually under that community plan structure of some sort. I would say we've not mentioned the local governance review up till now, but I think that definitely goes hand in hand with community wealth building. I think and CPP inquiry and reviews. It'll be interesting to see what comes out of that. I believe it's back on the agendas, which is great news. So if the local governance review comes out with something and looks at each of the individual CPPs, see what the local areas are requiring, what the cities require, how local does it need to get, or how local do people want it, I think that's going to be really interesting. You know? And I think ultimately it's about whatever makes it better for communities and supports local councillors, supports the local authorities to do the job within the communities, right, direct within it. So I think community wealth building is there's a long journey to go on with some of that to change the power, which is also where the local governance, you know, trust within the local communities to make things happen and deliver on contracts just the way other services and other organisations can. So communities can do it. Whether it sits under the community planning structure, I would say question mark still, because I think local governance review will be able to sort of highlight where the areas are, where it sits.
Good point. Thank you. Thanks, Camilla.
Thanks very much, Paul. So I'm going to pick up on the next theme, which has been mentioned a little bit, LOIPS. I think... So, Mark, you talked about the kind of dynamic between the LOIPs, so that was great that you brought that in, and what's going on the ground. So maybe I'll go to Valerie. Be interested to hear how your organisation aligns priorities with those in the LOIPs and the locality plans. And can you do you find, and you may have touched on this already a little bit too, do you find that there might be a conflict with your own organisational priorities, and how would you work with that?
Like Scottish Fire and Rescue, Police Scotland try their best to align their local policing plans, which emanate from the annual policing plan for the whole force, into the LOIPS. Obviously, there's aspects of the annual policing plan and local policing plans that community might not see as relevant to them, but it's still important. So, things in relation to radicalisation, counter-terrorism, etc., they might not necessarily see that. But on the whole, we do try to make sure that our local plans align with the local community planning LOIP. I suppose the only niggle with that is that potentially with all plans coming to the same place, sometimes the main plan for the LOIP can become a bit of a huge document. It's gathering too much information from too many people, and then it becomes a bit difficult. And that becomes demoralising for members of the Community Planning Partnership as they start to see that they can't necessarily achieve all the aims and objectives within the period set. So trying to make sure that, yes, we're aligning our targets, our aims and objectives within the LOIP, yes, but it's important that we don't put absolutely everything into that, because it's unfair in the Community Planning Partnership. I was listening to Dr. Escobar the other day's his contribution, the fact that it is such a small group in some areas in relation to community planning management of the organisation, it can become, you know, overburdenous if we've got too much within that. So we have to be realistic about what we could achieve in the time set. And sometimes that means an organisation like ours will maybe hold stuff that's specifically ours, as opposed to putting that in with the community planning LOIP.
Thanks very much for that. We've got a few more minutes on LOIPS. Does anyone else want to come in with a comment on it? Pauline?
Yeah, maybe add that again, regions, different regions that work differently, but certainly where it's worked best is where community action plans are from a bottom-up approach rather than still the top-down approach. And I think it's still quite relevant that to notice that community action plans from the community anchor organisation or third sector organisations aren't always at the first step. They're sometimes just joined in, and again, that sort of, it's not being at the front of the table, do you know, it's not being at the front of influencing it, and I think that could be improved on. I'd also like, you know, that's probably more a personal thing, not right from the membership, but we talk about investment more than improvement and just improvement. Do you know, it's investment in communities, it's investment in, you know, it's not always just about improvement. Do you know, it's about the long term, do you know, like the long term planning for it. So it'd be interesting to see some changes within even just the terminology of things as well. So
thanks very much for that. And Caroline, you wanted to come in.
Yes, just I think often that there are a lot of plans and a lot of strategies that we are all working with. And I think understanding the interlinkages between them is often a bit of a challenge, particularly at a national organisation where we have sort of strategic themes that we are working to and trying to integrate those across the 32 community planning partnerships is a challenge. From our side, we are, as I said before, are linked to the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, and within that, the National Tourism Strategy, which is Scotland Outlook 2030. And within that strategy, the community is very much embedded within that national tourism strategy through two particular themes, thriving places and passionate people. So I think if you're looking at it from a top-down or from a bottom-up approach, I would hope that there is the linkages between the different plans and strategies can clearly be made. We would work at an area level, so a local authority level, largely through the destination strategies. So if I use the example of Fife, for example, so they have Fife Tourism and Events Strategy, and which is led by the local authority, and therefore that would then link across into the LOIP. So whereas there may not be a direct route into it, I suppose I just wanted to make the point that I think there are clear links that can be made between the tourism strategies that we deal with and the LOIPs. And one other point that I just wanted to mention was around the regional activities. So as a national agency, we're doing more work at a regional level through regional economic partnerships. And I think it's perhaps a point to note around looking forwards as the regional economic partnerships are starting to develop. What is that link between LOIPs, community planning partnerships, and then the growing amount of regional activity that is happening? And are there certain things that can be dealt with at a regional level rather than perhaps a community planning partnership level?
Thanks very much for that. Interesting to hear your perspective again about the cluttered landscape of different plans and strategies, and how do we get the coherence across that? And I think it's not just with the community planning partnerships, it's across the field, I think. Okay, we're going to move on to the next theme, which is measuring impact. And Marie McNair, who's joining us online, will lead on that.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'll direct my first question to Stephen and Valerie. We heard last week how difficult it can be for CPPs to demonstrate impact. Given your role as a statutory body, how can CPPs measure the impact of activities and how they make the connection between local activity and broad outcomes?
Thank you.
I'll pop it to Stephen or Valerie.
Stephen's coming in.
That'd be great.
Stephen's going to come in, and then we'll go
first,
Valerie.
If that's okay. I think it's a really difficult question. A lot of the work we're talking about is preventative work, and how do we measure the things that haven't happened as a result of that work? A couple of examples that I could give. There's a recent initiative we've done in Aberdeen, and it was related to the number of secondary fires. So there was a really clear ownership. It sat with us, and it was really measurable. So we've done a significant piece of work with Police Scotland, Rangers, schools, local media, And we've driven down those fires over a period, and you know, we've proven that success. But what that can't measure is the impact it's had on the local community, the impact on services, the habitual nature that people were taking wheelie bins away, setting them on fire in the local wildlife reserve. So it's impacting the quality of life, it's impacting on the wildlife. So there's a number of different aspects there that we couldn't measure. With that one, we had something that we could. There's other examples of safe spaces around violence against women, and the stations are open and available, and we can connect to different organisations. But how do we measure how that is impacting on the community? It's available and it's there, but it's not that we've got a specific number we can put against that. We do employability schemes across the country, whether they're for offenders or whether there's school-age children through our youth volunteers, and it's all about preparing people to go into the workplace or preparing them to go into positive destinations. So over a lengthy period of time, we can see the outcomes, but it's very difficult to measure how much of that impact is a result of the work we do. So we do have a number of tools that we use to evaluate these initiatives. Within the service, we have an initiative library where one area will detail an evaluation, and we try to share that across areas, improve on it as we go. And likewise, the Scottish Community Safety Network have a case study library that we feed into and other organisations feed into. But again, that production of those case studies and production of the evaluation is quite time consuming. I think some areas are much better at it than others, but it doesn't mean that other areas aren't producing the work and producing the results. So I think we need to do some work around coordinating that evaluation, having a simple method to demonstrate the outcomes, and probably understanding the outcomes better. As an organisation, historically, we've been quite poor. We'll state we're going to drive down certain type of incident, and I'm not sure that's the approach we want to take. I think it's more about building that capacity within the community, informing people, educating, and that should be our aim, giving people tools and skills and knowledge, rather than looking at the very measurable bit. So hopefully that answers some of your question. I've probably just clouded that slightly further.
No, I don't know, Mark, you were here last week, obviously. I don't know if you want to add anything else before we move on to Valerie.
Yeah, very briefly. I suppose I can wear the two hats. So last week I was in as a representative from the Community Planning Improvement Board. I think Stephen touches on something important. It's about how do we collate and build that information around impact. Not everything can be done on a quantitative basis, but sometimes a good case study can give you more insight and value and understanding than anything. And if you can then also, through those case studies, tease out some of the issues about replicability, how could I maybe take that learning and apply it somewhere else, but in the way that will work in that community? And I think making sure that the intelligence flows across partnerships around some of that is quite important. I think we in the CPIB have got a role in that. But as an organisation, SFRS, we're also in that process, as Stephen says, about collating and gathering that information. So we published last year for the first time a national overview report. We'll replicate that again this year, that gives that breadth and depth of what we're involved in. And then if you want, you can find some of the detail that sits beneath all of that. And I think that's the best way you can begin to show the impact rather than necessarily measure the impact. Because some of this stuff, as we said last week, was, you know, it'll be decades in the making before we would truly know if some of what we're doing now has an impact. But the case studies at least give us that ability to say, now what can we show? And even if it's on a qualitative rather than a quantitative basis, that can be very, very powerful information. I think Oliver was saying something very similar last week as well. So more of that, but again, how do you share and how do you then pick it up and learn from it rather than just, it's an interesting story in itself.
Absolutely. Thanks, Mark. Valerie, are you okay to make some contribution?
Yep. So first of all, I would say prevention takes time, trust and money. And when I say trust, it's the trust that something is happening in the background. Police Scotland have an internal saying is we can't arrest ourselves out of this. And it's the sticking plaster effect of doing something that will make a change. So it's really important that we take a longer term view of some of the problems. And as part of our public health approach to policing, we are encouraging our officers to think of the causes of the cause as opposed to the specific nature of the why are we here? We're here because someone has stolen something, but why did they steal something? What's going on behind the scenes that's caused that criminality to happen? So we do use a lot of data, very data-driven, not only our own, but we use the Scottish Public Health Observatory data, we use Improvement Service Community Planning data, to provide that extra insight. However, one of the aspects of that is that sometimes it's quite, and it might be 3-yearly data, 5-yearly data, 10-yearly data sometimes. And because of that, it's more difficult to understand what you're doing and the effect it's having. Over the past couple of years, we've developed an opportunity to share potential suicide data. Now, we're not specifically saying that person has taken their own life, but we have started to kind of share that more quickly with public health colleagues in order that we can try to understand what's happening across and getting that understanding. This isn't statistics, this is management information, but it's giving us a bit more real time about what the effect is. So it helps us and it helps them do that cause and effect. So when you're doing, for example, a small test of change in an area, and you have to try and fail a couple of things maybe before you hit the nail on the head with a project that you want to deliver that will make a difference. So these small tests of change can only be done through getting dynamic information from other data sources. It's taken, in 2023, 10 years down the line, this year we'll see, at the end of this year, we'll see a single crime system across Scotland. It has taken us a long time to get single systems, and that will just be one of other single systems. We've still got more to do, but we will have one single system for crime. We'll add to the single system we have for command and control, vulnerable persons, etc. But we're continually developing that, and that takes time and money. But when I look at what's available across the 32 local authorities, they're all on different platforms, recording slightly different information, etc. So it makes that comparability about what works in one area and what works in another area a bit more difficult. The accessibility of that information as well, maybe not as good as it possibly could be in order to help influence decision making for other organisations. But we have to be data driven. But I would totally agree with Mark's point there about the information that's qualitative from members of the public. Are they seeing a difference? Are they feeling a difference? And that's an important thing, but I think sometimes we can be too quick to go back and ask that question. Sometimes we have to kind of do it on a more regular basis, and that takes you back to the question about whether or not we're engaging enough with our communities. We need to make sure we're continually engaged and purposefully engaged to ensure that we're getting the answers that we need in order to try and mould services we need to.
Thank you. That takes me neatly on to my next question, and obviously we covered a bit about data sharing, but to what extent has data sharing between partners improved since 2015, and what more can be done to ensure different bodies use local data to target interventions? And I'll pop it back to the police just now, firstly, and then we'll pass it on to the other stakeholders.
Valerie?
Sorry, that's my. So there is a lot of data sharing going on. I know that an awful lot of organisations come to us and say, could you not share more information? Could you not share more data? And part of our problem has been that inability we have had up until kind of more recently of single data sources with single data rules across the whole force. But that similarly becomes a problem when we're looking at other data sources that are out there. That single rule, the accessibility of a single platform, which can be used for research. There are various available, and Police Scotland are actively engaging with different organisations, as well as Scottish Government, about which platform to use to put our data on in order to do that sharing. But it's complicated. There's security issues, etc., that we need to consider. What information, how much information, what does it do? there's a level of ethics behind it, and we're learning from organisations like the NHS and Public Health Scotland at the moment. So there's definitely things that we can do to provide more information, that, because organisations are telling us all the time that it's really important that they have our information, and we're very willing to do it. But at the same time, we need information from them too. But those single data sets, single platforms are really the, I would say, the barrier. It's not the lack of will, it's just the technical aspects and the hardware aspects that are possibly going to cause us a problem.
What improvements have you seen since 2015, if any?
Although there have been improvements, because we're now aware of data that we weren't aware of before. We work closely with the Improvement Service, we work closely with the Public Health, and we get to see that information. Before, we were actually in a bit of a, we were just in a bit of a Police Scotland bubble. So now we're actually looking outwards, and it's through the discussions at CPPs and other meeting groups where we're able to say, do you know we've got that information, we've got that data, and that's where it really comes in so much more helpful. But it's just whether or not there's more, and I'm positive there's more out there.
Absolutely. I'll pop that onto the fire service and then open it up further.
I'll just touch briefly on it, because I agree with a lot of what we just heard there. I think data sharing has become something it's got better over the years, and I think GDPR has actually helped us in a lot of ways clarify when's it appropriate to share data and how do you do it in a safe fashion. So without going down the rabbit hole of GDPR, I think it's actually helped. But for me, I think the key issue is not so much the data sharing, but it's the insight and the intelligence from the data. It's how do we share that with one another? Because just sharing data for the sake of sharing data doesn't get you anywhere. What does the data tell you? And how do I then use that data as part of my organisation to target initiatives, to make sure that we're getting close to the right communities and households to safeguard them and keep them safe? And I think as partnerships, I think there's more we can do in that regard about picking out from the data that's there right across all of our data sets, what's it really telling us? What is it that's giving us an issue across our community, and therefore what can we do to then intervene in a way that's meaningful with that community? That's, I think, what we need to do more of, not just share the raw data. And I think having the partnerships that we've got around some of this is critical, not just across the statutory bodies, but if you look out in terms of the relationships with universities, for example, and using their skill and insight and working with the research community will help us mine that data and actually use it perhaps in a much more productive fashion, rather than we've just got data and we share data, but we don't actually do much with it thereafter. It's the use of it and the insight and the intelligence from it that I'd be keen to kind of see further development on across the partnerships.
Thank you.
Thanks for that, Mark. Marie, I'm going to actually have to wind up and move on, because we are scooting quite far past the time that we were going to close this.
Thanks, convener.
Thanks very much. I'm just going to come in with some questions around the culture of public bodies, and I'll direct this, Mark, first to you, and then I'll go to Valerie and Pauline. And I'm going to combine two questions in the interest of time. So with your experience of working across all CPBs, what, in your view, makes for successful community planning? And has the Act led to shared budgets and a sense of collective responsibility?
I think a number of things make for successful community planning. I think, as we discussed last week, and I'm sure you've heard from others, relationships matter. And I think through community planning over the years, even though you see changes in personnel across different organisations, it's allowed the organisations to interact much more. And I think what you tend to see from that is an understanding building up that to resolve the problems that I have, and Stephen gave some good examples from a fire perspective, other people have got a contribution that they can make to that, but in return I can make a contribution to their organisation priorities. So the relationships really matter. Having clear priorities for an area, and they're shared priorities, and we understand why their priorities is important. And I think, again, post-COVID, what I've seen with the LOIPs is there's a real sharpening of the LOIPs in light of the COVID experience. And I think there's greater clarity in what the local priorities are, and I think that's helpful. Does that lead to sharing of budgets? Not really. But I think, again, as we touched upon last week, it's not the budgets that you share that's important, it's what we do with those budgets. And invariably across all public bodies, those budgets are about employing people. How do we make sure that our people are tasked in the right ways, that they can work with a local community and local partners to do what's necessary to help address the issues that that community faces. And I think my experience, and certainly looking at it nationally, you're seeing more of that across the period since the Act came into being. We routinely, I think, are sharing more resources, joining up with resources. Some good examples have been cited again today. Wallacetown was one that's been cited in South Ayrshire. Really good example of where we are coming together and sharing resources across that community in ways that perhaps without community planning we wouldn't have done. I think that's probably more important than the budget side of things, because the budgets are controlled through a whole variety of means that have nothing to do with community planning, but you can share a resource in a way that you can't perhaps share a budget across public bodies.
Yeah, that makes sense. Valerie, how's it going in Police Scotland?
Police Scotland, yes. I think that one of the things that would that obviously creates a successful community planning partnership is that, as just as Mark said, the clear priorities that's comes out from all our regions of Scotland who participate in community planning. The other thing is partnerships in practice, but not just by name. So we've got an awful lot of partnerships just now. We've got community planning partnerships, community justice partnerships, health and social. We get partnerships coming out of our ears, there's lots of partnerships. But the question is, have we got that shared ambition? Have we got the shared responsibility that requires a partnership? And have we got the relationships? We participated with Improvement Service in the Collective Leadership for Scotland programme. And we trialled that in three areas of Scotland, which proved to be successful. However, the people moved on, and because the people moved on, that was that relationship part of it. It was kind of broken. So there does need to be, I think, some consistency around about the relationships, because it's the relationships that make a partnership, not just an okay partnership, but a really good partnership. Understanding your colleagues and their drivers, their inhibitors in relation to progress, etc. What's holding them back? And that's really an important part of it. In relation to the clarity as well, streamlining, because we see people attending partnerships, but not necessarily being able to give it their all, because there are so many meetings within the meeting structures. Definitely some necessity for some streamlining within community planning partnerships to make them successful. And in relation to shared budgets, as Mark said, it can be a bit of a frustration sometimes that we can't provide budgetary input, but we do always provide resources where we possibly can, and that could be in relation to doing our design team, providing access to resources that we've got, not only physical resources, officers, etc., but premises, etc. So we can do whatever we possibly can to try and encourage sharing without necessarily providing that budget.
Thanks very much. And Pauline, with the kind of community perspective.
I certainly agree with the majority that's been said between Valerie and Mark there. I think clear priorities, definitely, but I think they always have to be reviewed. I think communities, the needs of communities continually changes, and I think sometimes they don't get reviewed often enough. So the LOIPs and etc. will stay as they are for whatever period of time. They need to be generally reviewed regularly with communities in line, same way as community action plans. Relationships, absolutely. I think there has to be a respect and a trust. I think that's, again, goes back to the point that I made earlier regarding getting community anchors around the table and having an equal say. So I'll not repeat myself, but yeah, I think there needs to be that sort of respect and trust between all the partners to make sure that public bodies and communities have a respect and a trust between each other. So,
thanks very much. I'm going to move on now to our final theme, and that's local leadership, and that's being led by Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener, and hello to everybody. I just wanted to round off this section by talking a little bit more about leadership and the value of that and what it actually is and what it looks like and so on locally. I think somebody last week said it's hard to describe an elephant, but you'll know it when you see it. Is good leadership kind of like that? Because I've been picking up from you all as the conversation was developing there that there are good examples of it. And I think, Valerie, you were talking about it's all to do with personalities and people's ability to drive things forward. So I wonder if I could just invite a few comments from each of you to describe what you see as the key ingredients in a CPP in terms of the leadership to drive it forward. Maybe start with Pauline. Thank you.
I suppose I sort of laid into it with the trust and respect, isn't it? You know, like, there isn't one type of leader within any community. Every community is different, so the leaders are different. You know, they have to be open to lots of people's views and be able to listen and then put that into practice. So I think the leadership roles also come in different forms. Whether, you know, I talk of community anchors and development trusts, obviously, but you know, housing associations. There's different third sector organisations within those areas that all take different, slightly different approaches and also have different leadership roles within the community. I think it comes in all different, but I think respect and trust and listening to people and being able to adapt to what the reasons are, and also let go of control sometimes, you know, like, so it's not always about, you know, the control that you know the councillors or government or anybody, you know, local people have a lot of control there. And I think I said it earlier on, of working together makes everyone's jobs better, doesn't it? You know, so it actually improves the community if you let go of a bit of control or a bit of power, whatever you want to call it, to actually make a community better. So very much inclusiveness right across the board.
Thanks for that. Stephen, Mark, maybe a comment or two, please.
Yeah, I think Pauline summed it up well there. I think worth noting that the work of partnerships over the last few years really has been challenging through COVID. You can come into a meeting, people you've never met, it can be entirely online. It's quite a challenging environment to build a team and to have that leadership. I think we've done it quite well. So I've got quite a lot of hope that we're in a position now, as we're starting to get back around the table, we've been through something, and we're now in a position to push on from there. I think we'll see that trust development, the sharing of power. I think that sharing of power locally, it's part of the culture now. I think we will see it. We've done it, and I think we're in a position now to really advance. It is my own take, and it's certainly from my own organisation and my own experience of partnerships.
Thank you. Could I maybe hope to Valerie and then maybe Caroline, if that's all right?
Yeah, thank you. Just going back to my last point, first of all, a good leader facilitates as opposed to instructs and directs. So they facilitate that conversation, keeping it online, except keeping it focused. Think that ability to make sure that the community planning partnership has that clear focus, however, is the most important aspect of it. My comment is always, you can't eat an elephant, so don't even try to. It's an important aspect of what we're trying to do here. There's an awful lot of work that could be done within a community planning partnership, but you have to then become more focused about what can we physically do here, what can we do within our 3-year, 5-year, 7-year, whatever our target is, what's our aspirations. Aspirations are one thing, but what are we actually going to achieve within the shorter period of time with the partners, and have we got everybody signed up? And I think that the leadership has to facilitate and has to do that, some of that off-table conversations, building trust, building relationships, connecting people across different organisations in order to facilitate that better conversation.
Thanks for that, Valerie. Caroline?
I would agree with all of the points that the other panellists have made. For me, I think it's around that skill to be able to bring people together, to maintain the focus on the priorities so that the CPP is seen as being effective and arguably is effective. I think the other couple of points I would make, one is I think that the CPPs need to be or to recognise a degree of agility as well. So to be able to understand that other things may come in, agendas may come in, and to have that broad scope so that they can understand all the different positions from all the different organisations and facilitate those so that everybody feels that they're contributing. And I guess the final point was there is a huge difference between the organisations that sit around community planning partnerships from national organisations to small community groups. And I think the skill of the local leadership is around ensuring that everybody feels that they've got a part to play in the community planning partnership, whether that's at a very small level or at a significant level. And that, for me, is the essence of whether a community planning partnership is succeeding, because it's able to involve everybody, no matter what they can bring to the table. And that's quite a challenge, I think. But as we've hopefully demonstrated, some community plan partnerships are delivering on that.
Thank you. Maybe just ask one final question, convener, if there's time. And again, I think I've been picking this up from your comments, but I'll just ask you finally if you agree that we're seeing more shared leadership in the community planning partnerships than perhaps was originally the case when they began a long time ago, and it was very much driven by the local authorities. Are you seeing that broadening and widening of leadership roles taking place? And maybe have Mark an opportunity to come in.
Yes. I'm old enough and long enough in the tooth to remember when community planning first came in, 20 years or so ago, and facilitating discussions across some CPPs. And what was evident then was, for the first time, some of these organisations were actually coming together. People didn't know one another, never mind the organisations, the individuals didn't know one another. Now, there are exceptions. We've heard about some bodies perhaps not being fully represented in community planning, as they may well be, but I couldn't envisage that scenario of 20 years ago now. I think local organisations talk almost on a daily basis. People know individuals. I can pick up the phone and speak to Pauline because I've seen her at meetings and we've discussed stuff. And that building of the relationships over the last 20 years, I think, has been one of the key strengths that's come out of community planning, whether intentional or just by circumstances, take your pick. But I think that's given, I think, a platform that therefore you get that built and shared understanding of the local priorities across the leadership in communities. And I think that's invaluable to make community planning actually work. And I think that's something we should have a look at and kind of learn from. How do we maintain that quality of relationship at a local level and ensure those organisations are talking not just about the business stuff, but out with that and building the quality of the relationships, because that's what really drives things.
Thank you. Would that be your experience as well, Pauline? Would you share that?
I think definitely it's improved, you know. So as I say, again, I feel like a broken record about different regions do it different ways, do you know, like, so there's pockets definitely in the country that maybe don't do it as well and could improve, but whether that's a standard tool for community planners or something like that that's maybe needed so that they learn off, that there's a learning going across the country about the ones that are doing it really, really well, do you know, like, and are involved in the communities. So I never want to take away from, you know, and I'm not going to name names, but that, you know, that we should learn off each other. Communities learn off each other all the time, so should community planning partnerships and what works well in different other areas. So, but yes, I would say in general it's got there. I mean, the Community Empowerment Act has definitely made a difference of communities being taken more seriously. But yeah, there's still a way to go, I would say, still, though, because there's more and more that communities want to do for themselves, and local leadership within those being encouraged and supported, and quite rightly through Scottish Government with the Empowerment Act and Community Wealth Building Bills and various other things, you know. So there's lots more to do. But yeah, I would, in general, it's moved forward. Just, we need to keep talking about what else needs to be done.
Thanks, Paul. Maybe a last comment, Valerie, Caroline, just to wind us up.
I would suggest that probably we have definitely seen Police Scotland senior officers chair community planning partnerships across Scotland. Not often, but regularly enough. However, we've got 13 divisions and there are 32 local authorities, so there's 32 planning partnerships. Trying to spread that equity across the board is difficult for any single organisation, particularly a national organisation. But the other thing is, it's not only about the chairmanship of the community planning partnership, but it's also administration of that. And we know that the administration can be and will be difficult. And we've just heard about what a good leader is, and being able to do that as well as your day job is a big ask of anybody within that executive team. So it is a big commitment, and one that does have to be shared, and there's no easy way to do that, but we'd always try. I think there's not one organisation in community planning that would shirk away from that responsibility unless really pushed because of other demand.
Thanks, Valerie. Caroline?
Yes, and just to add again, I would agree. I was going to make the point Valerie made around the administration of the community planning partnerships, which I think in the main still continues to fall to the local authorities. And I think that's a really essential role that they play, that continuity, which is important. And therefore, if we're able to rotate the chair side of things, then I think certainly my experience through the Angus Community Planning Partnership has been that that's been the case, to kind of share the load a little bit. I think it has been a success bringing these, what was potentially a disparate group of organisations together over the last, I guess, 20 years, more recently for us, has been a really useful exercise. I think we have got more understanding of what we are doing as different organisations and how we can collectively work together, but also a better understanding of what communities want and what communities need. And if we can do that more efficiently and more effectively, then that has to be a good thing.
Thanks for that, Caroline. I believe I'm getting another question from the convener. There's a little bit more time than I thought. It's probably more for the police and fire colleagues. And we know that the Improvement Service has got a checklist for community planning that includes understanding issues about governance and duties to facilitate community planning and so on, and you have to take reasonable steps to make sure that it happens carefully and properly and so on. How do you make sure that you comply with that kind of requirement?
Well, again, I think if you look at us, Stephen can maybe add to this, that across each of the 32 areas, you know, we are represented at the CP board. We'll also be active across a range of the partnerships that then sit under the CP itself, and I think what we do is to make sure at a national level that those arrangements are in place. And I say through the planning arrangements, we make sure that the LSO, the local senior officer for an area, has that ability to make sure that they can adapt the local plan to suit the local needs of the area. So that's the kind of very much of the approach that we take. I mean, Stephen can speak more from the sharp end of all of this, but for us, that's been a very important message throughout the time of the service, that, you know, our strapline is a national service delivered locally. Well, you can only do the local part if you're locally embedded through the CPP with your partners and the community itself. And that's very much part of the DNA of the organisation. I don't know if you want to add to that, Stephen.
Yeah, I think Valerie touched on the difficulty as a national service when you're structured in such a way that we've got 14 local senior officers trying to service 32 CPPs, but we have local commanders in each area that's responsible for that. So it's, as Mark says, it's about us delegating power down the way and very much learning and listening to what we're hearing on the ground to then support it as a national body.
Thanks, Stephen. Valerie, how does Police Scotland ensure that you meet those requirements that I just outlined there?
Yeah, so the Improvement Service obviously provides an awful lot of information to prospective members of community planning partnerships, and it's important that we try to adhere to that. I think, however, the actual situation is that we've got people attending, not necessarily the executive team, but possibly within the thematic groups, and that will maybe be delegated and potentially even delegated again because of the effect of the volume of meetings that our officers have to attend, particularly our senior officers have to attend. As I said, it's a community planning partnership is just the one partnership, but of that partnership, there are so many others that are equally as important, such as community justice, community safety, children's panels, etc. There's a huge amount of other work involved. So possibly preparation for officers moving into the community planning could be better, but tends to be that they've all had an opportunity to dip their toe in the water as they've been promoted through the ranks, because they'll have been involved in locality groups, thematic groups, all the way up to the executive group.
OK, thank you very much for those contributions, Convener.
Thanks very much, Willie. I'm just going to pop back in and again direct another question to the Police Scotland and the Fire and Rescue Service, so maybe to Mark. So Section 16 of the Act places a duty on the Scottish Government to promote community planning, and I think we'd be interested to hear to what extent this is happening, for example, in ministerial letters of guidance, budget decisions, or national strategies. Do you have a sense of that? So, Mark, maybe I'll go with you and then I'll come to Valerie.
Okay, yep. So as a national service, we have to operate against the Fire and Rescue Framework for Scotland. So essentially Scottish Government's priorities for the service. And within the national framework, there's a clear direction to us about the importance of partnership working, particularly through community planning, but just as we were hearing from Police Scotland, not exclusively so. So very much part of that message and that priority setting from government is the importance of partnership. That in turn is then reflected in our strategic plan. We have a priority and outcome set around that so we can meet the national ask, and then that tiers its way down through the planning frameworks of the organisation. And then culturally around about that, as we say, it's very much about how do we empower people to then act within that framework. So between us and government, I think it's very much part of their ambition for the fire service is to be that active partner within community planning, and through that, that adds to community safety and therefore to help us achieve the outcomes that we set out to achieve. So very much in partnership, no puns intended, with government on that, that there's a very, very strong message from them.
That's very heartening to hear that there's this framework that puts that partnership work right in the centre there. Valerie.
Yes, Section 32 of the Police and Fire Reform Act requires us to work in partnership and to work in relation to prevention. So yes, it is very much part of our organisation's culture within legislation and also within our wish to be that we work in partnership with other organisations. And that obviously comes, as I say, from the initial piece of legislation that governs our acts and processes. In relation to kind of other aspects, we participate across the board. We have really close links with Scottish Government in a variety of different departments. And I suppose the only fly in that ointment is the fact that it is across so many different departments, and some of these issues that community planning partnerships that deal with, it's not just the communities, Safer Communities team, or directorate within Scottish Government deal with it. It covers a wide range of different things, from health, homelessness, income, enterprise regeneration. There's an awful lot involved in it, and so therefore it's not just about the one department. It's about the connectivity between government departments that really helps to make that connectivity at the community planning a bit more real.
Thank you very much for that. It's been actually very interesting. I mean, that brings us to the end of the session. It's been very interesting to hear from all of you the different experiences of community planning working, and to hear how embedded it is, and clearly is a bit of a direction of travel, and there's a challenge around how do you get everybody around the table and not have it be this thing that I think somebody said earlier, that it becomes overwhelming. You have an overwhelming strategy plan that people actually feel they can't actually get the action on the ground. But I think it seems to be a very dynamic process, and it's been really good to hear from all of you today. So I'm now going to suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. On our second panel, we're joined by Derek Shaw, who's the Director of Innovation and Place from Scottish Enterprise, Karen Jackson, who's the Director of Strategy, Partnership and Engagement at the South of Scotland Enterprise, Sharon McIntyre, who's the Head of Career Information Advice and Guidance, and Dave McCallum, who's the Head of Operations Southeast at Skills Development Scotland, and Ian Sinclair, who's the Area Manager at Caithness in Sutherland, Highlands and Islands Enterprise. Now, welcome our witnesses to the meeting. As mentioned to the first panel, we'll try to direct our questions to a specific witness where possible, but if you would like to come in, please indicate this to the clerks by typing an R in the chat function. And Sharon and Dave, just in the interest of time, I'd be keen if one or other of you can pick up, if you can decide in the background between yourselves who's going to come in on an answer, that would be great. Or maybe a colleague will direct a question to one or other of you, and if that's hopefully gets the response, that would be good. There's no need to manually turn your microphones on and off, as we'll be doing that for you automatically. So we're going to start with the theme of challenges facing communities with Annie Wells, who's also online.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Scottish Enterprise's submission states that their customer base is the business community. How well are businesses engaging with CPPs, and what more can be done to ensure businesses, both small and large, can help identify and meet local priorities? And I think I'll go to Derek for that one first, please, convener.
Thank you very much indeed for the question. So Scottish Enterprise is represented on 24 community partnerships as a statutory partner. And rightly commented there that I think our experience in terms of the level to which economic development and job creation within the discussions around community planning partnerships actually feature. I think there's, and that extends into the involvement with business organisations. I think there's an opportunity for businesses as a community of interest, if you like, to play a greater role in community planning partnerships, and to ensure that we're kind of focused on those discussions that we have at CPP boards around job creation within local communities and how that then dovetails in with the plans of CPPs.
Thank you for that, Derek. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that one, but it was probably more specifically for Derek, that question. I'll move on to my next question, convener.
Thanks, Annie. Yep.
Oh, no, Karen, sorry.
South Scotland Enterprise, we have a slightly easier job than Scottish Enterprise because we engage with two CPPs. So that economic focus is really important. I think you'll hear quite a lot from both SE High and ourselves about regional economic development. So in the Borders particularly, the CPP there has agreed that the regional economic partnerships should take on that area of economic development. So on the regional economic partnership, we have business members. So you get that voice coming through that way. It's slightly different in Dumfries and Galloway, where there's an economic forum, again, picking up that big business voice. So as Derek's highlighting, making sure that we're hearing really directly from business is important. Both we and Highlands and Islands Enterprise do a regular business survey just to really take the pulse of businesses in our areas. Again, we're able to feed in a good understanding of what businesses are wanting, are needing, and the challenges they're facing. Thanks.
Thanks, convener. I'll move on to my second. Oh no, there's another. I think Ian wants to come in.
Yeah. Yes, thank you. Good morning. Actually, building on what Karen just said, we have now begun to gather quite a bit of data in terms of how we interact with businesses in relation to community planning. We've also managed to, over the last 12 months, do a My Life in the Highlands and Islands survey, which has encompassed both businesses and communities. One of the things that I noted from our COVID experience has been just how much broader and deeper that engagement has become, both between us and businesses, but also between businesses and community sectors. So that's been a really interesting process to observe, and I think that's an ongoing process that we'll learn more from.
Thanks. That's great, Ian. Thanks for that. My next question is sort of a building on this as well, and it's, what role do enterprise agencies and Skills Development Scotland have in promoting fair work at local level? And if you have any examples of where the agencies have influenced CPPs or LOIPs? And I think we'll go to, can I go to either Sharon or Dave on that one first, please?
Dave. We can't hear him. Dave, we can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, brilliant.
Don't know what happened there, I do apologise.
That's all right.
It's something we do try and influence, and obviously it's becoming a topic of significant importance. We influence and from young people, from schools, we do, our careers advisors talk about kind of fair work at an early age, from broad general education, from S1, S3, right through the senior phase. And it's also when we're talking about employability and the opportunities out there that we bring up fair work and talk about fair work, not just with our young people that we support, but also with our adult customers as well. Is it something that's been embedded within the LOIPs? I think it's something that's been spoken about more now, and I definitely think it'll be something that we'll start to see more in the LOIPs as we move forward. But I wouldn't say it's specifically there in the CPPs that I've supported so far. That's me.
Thanks.
Thanks for that, Dave.
Anybody else want to come in on that question? Derek.
Yeah, so I think at the macro level, Scottish Enterprise was an early adopter of fair work first, so requiring businesses that are receiving our support to commit to fair work principles, including paying the living wage, with it implementing the Fairer Scotland duty, which asks listed public sector authorities and agencies, including Scottish Enterprise, to do more to tackle inequalities by socioeconomic disadvantage. And part of this is part of our wider economic impact assessments, which is a way for us to check policy and projects that we are supporting and how they impact targeted groups. And certainly at the CCP level, the colleagues from Scottish Enterprise regularly raise the importance of fair work in the context of discussions around economic development and job creation. Going back to that earlier point, some of those conversations can be limited overall just by the wide-ranging remit of CPP.
Thank you for that, Derek. I think Ian wants to come in.
Yeah, I was actually going to say something similar to Derek. Again, we were an early adopter of fair work. It's a condition of all our assistance. It has been met very positively, I have to say, by our both businesses and social enterprises. It has also, I think, helped us in our participation in things like developing the young workforce. So it does show that we are walking it like we talk it.
And Karen as well?
Yeah, just to really reinforce what colleagues in Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise have said, fair work is central to everything we do. As the newest of Scotland's economic development agencies, it's embedded in our act, so it's something that we live and breathe. We have something that's in our act is described as our Workers' Interest Committee, and that's a committee that really helps us to understand what's impacting on workers across the region. And again, we can take that intelligence out into the conversations we're having. And as colleagues have highlighted, fair work is conditional on the support that we're giving to both businesses and community organisations, and that conditionality is being strengthened.
Thank you very much for that. Thank you, panel, and I'll hand back to yourself, convener.
Thanks, Annie. We're now going to move on to our second theme of the morning, still the morning, which is community empowerment, and that's going to be led by Mark Griffin.
Thanks, convener. I just wanted to ask how community participation is influencing how your organisation operates, and to ask as well whether that has changed at all, how it has changed in the 8 years since the Community Empowerment Act was passed, and perhaps come to Shardon first and then Derek.
Good morning, convener. Good morning, panel. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes, good, good. So thank you for the question. In terms of SDAs, I'm representing Information Advice and Guidance Directorate of SDS. But as a whole, we are a key partner across 32 CPP and play an active role in supporting both at executive level and themes and through theme groups around tackling inequalities. Now, we've always, as an agency, had a deep commitment to our communities. We're an all-age service in CIAG, so we support adults as well as Dave mentioned, our services in schools. And we've always had a focus on supporting our communities' needs and understanding them by our local presence. So for us, in terms of CPPs, it gives us an opportunity not only to work together with partners around our community's interests, but also represent them. We are in touch with customers every day, adults and children and young people. So we feel that we are very connected to them in the communities that they're in. In fact, we have just been working for over the last 2 years on a new career services blueprint. You might have heard of Careers by Design. But what that piece of work is about how we actually enhance our community presence. One of the key recommendations in that is working with partners across the careers and skills ecosystem to do much more community delivery and engagement. And it's not just about delivery engagement, it's about how we design services with our communities. And we are very aware of the areas where we feel there needs to be a focus on supporting good outcomes. So those areas where we know outcomes comparably aren't as good as other communities, we've got a wealth of data through our own customer service system, the data hub that we share information through CPPs. So we bring local market intelligence, but also we bring intelligence and data around what we see happening in communities through our direct engagement with customers. So our new Careers by Design report just launched last week, actually, panel. We're looking to bring a much closer focus to the ecosystem, the skills and careers ecosystem, how we deliver services for customers. And a big part of that is putting lived experience at the heart of how we operate our services. And I think that's something we bring to CPP as well, is where is the community when we're talking about specific agendas around housing, poverty, skills, employability. And we very much see ourselves as a driving force for the community as well as working with partners to deliver to real community needs that have changed since COVID, but we are still seeing the same community challenges that we did, I would even argue, 20 years ago in some different shapes and form. We also in CIEG as a directorate have a clear poverty focus, because when we look at how we are delivering services, some of the barriers our customers are facing now more than ever, that's related to poverty. So we are working with Morag Trainer, who's a well-known professor in children's studies, to help us, SDS, be a critical friend to us around what are we doing about how we tackle poverty as a national skills agency, and how do we bring in that focus to community planning partnerships, which would maybe in some ways in the past wouldn't have thought skills agency had a direct role and could have a direct impact in that agenda. But now we can definitely see the development of CPPs, I would say, since the Community Empowerment Act, to understanding just how important our role is in that agenda. And so moving from what would have been quite sector silos before CPPs and certainly before the Community Empowerment Act, it's allowed us to work across areas, across agendas, across priorities that affect our local community. And like other organisations, we're a national organisation, but very much delivering locally, connected to local partners. I hope that answers your question.
Thanks, Sharon. Derek, do you have anything to add from Scottish Enterprise point of view?
Yes, thanks very much for the question. So several years ago, Scottish Enterprise put in place a place team. And that was in response to, I guess, a number of things, including the Community Empowerment Act, recognising the placemaking. And as part of that place team, we put in place partnership teams in each of the seven regions in which Scottish Enterprise is ability for. And those partnership teams and colleagues within them work on those 24 CPP boards that I had outlined at the start. So there's about 15 colleagues in total from Scottish Enterprise attending or participating in CPP boards and subgroups. So not an insignificant resource from SE. I think over the last 12 months in particular, we've tried to ensure that the resource that we deploy on CPPs is proportionate to overall outcomes and where we really can add the most value. And I think there's kind of guidance within the Act that kind of says that the specific contributions should depend on the extent to which CPP's local priorities reflect individual bodies, including SE's roles and responsibilities. And I think that's the case for us. We've got limited resource, both people and financial, so it is important we prioritise that scarce resource and it's going to happen. The greatest impact. And as Karen mentioned, often and increasingly so, our focus has been working with regional partners through regional economic partnerships and strategies and developing approaches there on how Scottish Enterprise can deliver activity to support those ambitions at a regional level, but still working very much closely with CPPs and the resource that we deploy into them.
Thanks, Derek. I wonder if I could come to Karen and Ian, just my second question. Just ask about how you go about building capacity in the more deprived areas, the more marginalised rural areas. How do you build capacity within those communities to make sure that they're in effectively contributing to getting the voice heard and how services are delivered for them?
Karen, do you want to come in?
Yes, sorry, I think I might be having problems with my R button, I apologise. So that listening to communities piece is really essential for us, and it's how we've shaped ourselves as we've been established. So our chair and chief executive last year did 23 events across the south of Scotland, again, just to really listen to what communities wanted of us. So that phrase of the south and by the south is really important to us. As we've been in developing our regional economic strategy, similarly, that listening piece has been really important. So by the end of the process, we'd heard from over 2,000 people across the south. So by online surveys, by one-to-one conversations, by different workshops. So just different ways of gathering insight from communities. I think that point you highlight about rural communities for us is really key. Obviously, we're a predominantly rural area. We've got within SOCI, we have the Enterprising Communities team, and they're out there on the ground working with communities across the south, building the capacity and capabilities. So you see them involved in community asset transfers from big to small. So Langham, one of our biggest, other areas, smaller and different kinds of support. And through that capacity and capability building, you see communities across the South being able to engage more effectively, both in community planning, but in really unleashing their ambitions as well.
Thanks, Karen. Ian, do you have any insight?
We've had sorry, that unmute took a while to come off. Yes, I agree with what Karen has said. I think the community capacity building element to HIE's work has been there for a long time. I think at the moment this is rebuilding capacity. I think we saw during COVID a real resilience and survival instinct kick in for a lot of our communities and a lot of the social enterprises as well. We're now in that rebuilding phase, moving from resilience survival. And I think we've, and I can speak from my own local perspective in the north of Scotland, we're investing in boots on the ground to help that process, because I don't think there's any substitute for that.
Thanks, Ian. I had a final question, but Derek covered that in his previous answer.
Yeah,
so
Dave wanted to come in.
Sorry. Yeah, thanks, panel. I just wanted to come in. I mean, although as SDS, I suppose our job, not just within careers, information, advice and guidance, but also across skills, is we link people of communities and local areas, especially some of those most deprived and rural areas. And I think it's important here just to link in the role of some of the subgroups that feed into the CPPs and the intelligence that they bring. So like our local employment partnerships, how ourselves and other agencies help shape kind of how that provision's been deployed to support employment opportunities, empower the community, embedding in some community asset transfers. It's boots on the ground that helps, but it's the flexibility to be able to deploy those resources. I thought that's the good thing from a national agency, that we can deploy those resources flexible to where the need is. That is challenging at times, but key to that as well is working collaboratively with partners. So when SDS goes in, it's not just SDS, it's other partners as well, from local employability partnerships, third sector, NHS, fire, police, whoever, to support those communities. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Dave.
Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Mark. We're going to now move on to our third theme, which is the role of the third sector and communities, with Paul McClellan.
Thanks, Camina, and good morning, panel. I suppose that this is the next question, trying to base around about what your involvement is with third sector and how you then take it into your decision making and then into the community planning partnership. And Ian, I'll probably come to yourself first of all, and then probably Karen after that, in terms of trying to look at it from a Karen, you touched it from a, you mainly deal with rural communities, and Ian would be yourself the same. So Karen, I'll probably come to yourself in terms of how do you engage with a rural community which could be quite dispersed, and how do you engage with the third sector in particular and take that into your local, I suppose, community planning discussions? That'd be to yourself, Karen.
Oh, sorry. Thank you for that. So we have really proactive relationships with the third sector interfaces, particularly in Dumfries and Galloway. So regular conversations with Norma Austin Hart, the chief executive there, to really understand what the organisations she represents are experiencing. As you say, that rural piece is really challenging. So we need to be able to understand the challenges facing rural communities across the region. So particularly during cost of living crisis, that's different for rural areas, and through the TSI and through our other contacts, that helps us understand it. The Borders is in a slightly different place. Their third sector organisations are now coming together in the TSI. So some changes in the Borders there. Again, through our communities team and through other conversations, we have I think close relationships with them. Both TSIs are represented on our regional economic partnership, so they have seats around that table, and other third sector organisations and social enterprises are there as well. But again, at that regional level, the TSIs are really key. Norma in the west of the region has been doing a bit of analysis about how we see the TSI and how they're engaged, so that ladder engagement piece, to really ensure that they are an equal partner and their voice is heard. I think that was a theme coming out, particularly from Pauline at your previous session, about respect and equality and equality of representation. So I think the TSIs in on both sides of our region are there at the table and their voices are heard.
Thanks, Karen. And Ian, from yourself, obviously from the other part of the country and remote and high area, where do you find your experience in that regard?
Yeah, absolutely fundamental to any progress we make in the CPPs is the presence of the third sector at the table and in a meaningful way. We, before COVID, were collectively across the Highlands and Islands working on that principle. But I think, again, as I've said before, COVID really brought that starkly into relief. And we saw how effectively the third sector stepped up when some CPP structures simply ceased because partners had other priorities. Third sector stepped up. I'll speak briefly about my own area. I chair the Caithness Community Planning Partnership, which is a sub-regional version of the Highland Community Planning Partnership. During COVID, that was effectively co-chaired by myself and the local TSI. And it was the resilience effort that went in there that has led to has formed the basis of the recovery plan that we are now coming out the other end of. So without that presence and without their boots on the ground, that wouldn't have been possible and wouldn't have allowed us to bring in communities of interest. We have a phenomenally well-developed women's health organisation up here now, which came through COVID and is now up and running and delivering really positive messages and delivering visibility to conditions that weren't previously talked about. That's all within a community planning structure that is inclusive rather than exclusive.
Okay. Ian, thanks for that.
Sharon.
Yes, hello, panel. I just wanted to come in on Ian's point there. I myself was up in Orkney for the launch of a new employability hub. And that depends on the third sector. Third sector partners critical to how that will serve the community. And that's with us and other statutory partners, but also that it's the third sector and their role deep in communities and their focus, which is around customers primarily in that area, and looking at what more could be done and significant voice around customers not telling their story, communities not telling their story a number of times, that being joined up and integrated, and we having a duty to do that. So I think, the third sector, absolutely vital. We in SDS do all we can to promote our work with third sector. We've got a strategic agreement with developing young workforce, but we've extended that to MCR Pathways, to Prince's Trust, to Youth Link, because we cannot do what we do on our own. And the value they bring as partners are incredibly powerful. And we're recognising that strategically as well as locally. Even in Glasgow, we're making some changes to our estate strategy in SDS. As you know, we've got a centre in every city. But we're looking at actually why can't they be much more integrated employability hubs why do we need, you know, separate premises? Maybe not too distant from each other as well. But I do, and the third sector are driving that focus as well with us. And of course, within a quite a tighter fiscal environment that we all face, it is a fantastic opportunity to get back to the act and talk about actually how we are helping customers and communities help themselves and how they support the direction of services locally as well as nationally. So a massive focus in third sector for us. Thank you.
I think that's a really important point around about the shared services kind of element as well. So, Derek, just to come to yourself from the Scottish Enterprise point of view, just to from your point of view, obviously looking at, I suppose, a much broader national base, how do you involve the third sector, if you like, in that regard?
Yeah, so I guess I would just echo the points there that Shannon made in particular. I think that having the input, the knowledge and experience, the locality of the third sector is absolutely critical. I think what's really interesting is that latter point around co-development, potentially co-location, so that you're bringing together partners that really know and understand each other's organisations' remits and how then that we can work together benefit the local community. And I think in terms of the challenging fiscal environment that we're seeing, those opportunities that are coming to the fore more, and that includes working with the third sector as well. So absolutely, we encourage that and support their contribution to ACPs and the kind of supports in which they operate as well.
Correct. Thank you for that. Thanks, convener.
Thanks, Paul. We're now going to move on to our next theme, which is on LOIPs and locality plans. And I've got a couple of questions. The first one's around alignment and the second one's about around prevention. And just in the interest of time, I'd be grateful if we can keep your answers, which are so great and we really want to hear from you, but if we can keep them as succinct as possible. I think I'll direct this first question to Derek to start, just so you know it's coming to you, and then we'll go to everybody else. So we've heard that LOIPs are the foundation of community planning, and I'd be interested to hear how your organisation aligns your priorities with those in the LOIPs and the locality plans, and if you find that at times there might be conflict with those plans and your own organisational priorities.
Yeah. Thanks very much for the question. So we very much see the benefits of local LOIPs as allowing partners to collectively assess and agree priority outcomes that can be taken forward for delivery, and bring together those partners, local people, community groups that will have an important role in identifying those priority outcomes. I think for us, the key is ensuring that the plans are stretching but achievable, and it's not a long list of activity that ultimately partners will not be able to deliver on. I think for us, it's ensuring that we are clear on Scottish Enterprise's strategic priorities and where we can add value at the regional and the local level, and clearing our roles and responsibilities as part of that process. Recognising that, going back to the earlier point, a lot of the outcomes and the actions within LOIPs and CPPs more generally are out with the remit of SE, but really being clear on where we can add value relative to our own strategic priorities, and then being clear on how that then relates into the outcomes, the prioritised outcomes as they relate to LOIPs, and how we can support potentially delivery of them.
Thanks very much for that. Maybe we could go to Karen and then Ian.
Thanks. So we have a slightly broader remit in that we cover economic, social and environment development. So a remit that puts us across most of the elements of what community planning partnerships are working on. I think for us, and I think you heard this from other national agencies, obviously the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, that's kind of what we're doing nationally. Regionally, we have our regional and economic strategy. So a focus on creating a green, fair and flourishing south of Scotland, and then the community plans fit into that. So I think somebody was describing it earlier, cluttered landscape. I think, perhaps a complex landscape, but you do see alignment through the plans and you do see how they join together. I think for us, I don't think we see any conflict with what are in the LOIPs and the local plans. I think we see ourselves contributing across the piece, and I think there's a good fit to what we do as an organisation. There's also a focus on place plans, so again, it's a kind of slightly smaller geographic area, and we're involved with the local authorities in developing those, so that some of that flows from our Borderlands growth deal. So again, lots of plans, but I do think we see a link between them.
That's great to hear that you're managing to pull that link through. Ian, how's it going in the Highlands and Islands?
I echo most of Karen's thoughts there, and I think the only thing I would add to it is in terms of the LOIP, we are pretty much now at a halfway point, and I think somebody has already in your previous session referred to the need to make sure that those are refreshed, and I think that's a process that certainly from a Highland CPP we are embarking on at the moment, and that will help us in terms of COVID recovery. In terms of locality plans, we in several areas of the Highlands and Islands have found them less useful because of the very small communities that we deal with, all of whom tend to have similar needs expressed both pre-COVID and during COVID. So we are increasingly looking at area plans rather than locality plans to encompass the fragile geographies that we deal with.
Thanks for that, Ian. Just for a little bit of clarity there, when you talk about area plans, what kind of geography would you?
So that would be in terms of Highland, that could be Lochaber or Sutherland or an area like that.
Okay.
That is a more coherent geographic area.
Great, that's helpful. Thanks very much. And Dave, I think you wanted to come in.
As SDS, we feed into the LOIPs. We support evidence around participation measures, local labour market information, and focusing on some of those areas maybe where there's young people that aren't transitioning to a positive destination. We will work very closely with partners to try and make sure that we support them, identifying and giving them the right support, but also to those areas where there's maybe low unemployment as well in adults, we will focus and deploy our services to support that. And that does feed back up into our strategic plan as well. That's the link to our statutory responsibility to support all ages in Scotland. That's great. Me. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks very much for that. I'm now going to move on to the theme of prevention, and I'd be interested to hear, and Karen, I'll start with you so you know it's coming to you first. To what extent has your organisation taken a more preventative approach since the 2015 Act was passed? And what role have LOIPs and community planning had in your organisation's consideration of prevention?
In terms of prevention, I think we're about creating opportunities, if that's the same kind of area of focus. So as an enterprise agency, as a development agency, we're working with businesses and with community organisations to really help unlock their ambition. And I think for us, we see that creating opportunity piece is really key. So both with our funding, with the direct work we're doing, one-to-one support, helping communities develop capacity and develop their expertise, that helps us prevent problems downstream. So although we've now, what we're celebrating our third birthday at the beginning of April, we're proud of the record that we've had in the south of Scotland. So we've worked with businesses to safeguard jobs and to create more jobs. So about 2,200 jobs safeguarded last year, and over 800 new jobs created in businesses, a similar kind of support within community groups. So 150 jobs there safeguarded and 80 new jobs created. So for us, it's about creating those opportunities so that people have decent, good employment to really unlock their ambitions as they move forward.
Thanks for that, and the great work on safeguarding all those jobs. That's really critical for that part of the country. And Ian, how's it going up in the Highlands and Islands for a preventative approach?
Yeah, I was taking a similar approach to Karen there, actually, in terms of our ability to unlock opportunities or to help people unlock opportunities. I think I mentioned before that we have geographic and demographic communities of interest in the Highlands and Islands. And in terms of prevention, we see a lot of food banks, which are hugely important at the moment, but we are lucky also to have social enterprises in our area that are talking about community growing projects, which I regard as preventative projects. So we've got lots of examples of that. If you look beneath the surface of some of the investments that we make, and that's as much in social enterprises as it is in business development. So it's good to see them in both.
That's great. And community growing is something I'm very strongly supportive of. So it's great to hear that that's happening there. Dave, I think you wanted to come in.
Yes, Chair. Just on prevention, I mean, we're in a very unique position with our data, working with local authorities and education at schools, that we know the aspirations of young people who are leaving school, so the employment sector and the trades they want to go into. So we try and feed that up with partners, with DWP, into the LOIPs, into the CPPs, etc., around kind of what are young people want to do when they leave school. Actually trying to pair that up with the opportunities that are coming from employers, because sometimes there can be a mismatch there. And then it's how we try and share that with our wider partners and the employers as well. And also raising the awareness of what employers can do by offering apprenticeships to young people, especially in rural areas, and the opportunities that apprenticeships can bring. And we do have teams that go around supporting employers to talk about fair work as well, to look at the opportunities about moving their bases to the north of Scotland or to more rural areas as well. So we're data rich, but we share that with our partners to try and make sure that anything that's been designed impacts local communities positively. Thank you.
Thanks for that. And yes, the apprenticeship schemes are critical, aren't they, for keeping people actually locally based. So good for repopulation or maintaining population. Derek, you wanted to come in.
Very much indeed. Just to kind of build upon the point that Karen made. So I guess COVID taught us as an enterprise agency the importance of prevention in terms of working with companies around resilience. So ensuring that we have foresight through an account management service of potential future challenges that companies are facing, and working with them proactively to avoid situations which could ultimately lead in and then reduce employment or potentially going under. So that whole piece around how we can work with companies not only on growth opportunities, which was critically important in terms of preserving and creating new jobs, but also resilience and looking at productivity, how we can work with companies. Is there productivity, their overall financial position to mitigate the risks of kind of financial challenges with businesses. And I think 2021 in particular, we supported the creation of about 7,000 jobs paying the real living wage. So it's a kind of demonstration of how we can work with companies, get existing jobs as well. But that resilience piece is important as well as new opportunities for business growth in a number of different sectors where Scotland has a real competitive advantage.
Thanks very much for that, Derek. Really interesting to hear the perspectives around prevention there and this idea of creating opportunities. We're going to move forward to theme 5, which is about measuring impact. And I'm going to bring in Marie McNair, who's joining us online today.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. We heard last week how difficult it can be for CPPs to demonstrate impact. And given your role, how can CPPs measure their impact, and how can they make the connection between local activity and broad outcomes? and I'll pop that to Skills Development Scotland first, if that's okay.
Dave?
Marie?
Okay, Sharon?
Yes, I think for us, impact is critically important. There is a real focus on looking at what we can do to work towards solutions. So there's a big input focus. But also, I think for us, given what Dave was saying around the data-rich position we're in, we would like that to be a bit more outcome-based. So in terms of SDS's role, what we would like to be able to say in our annual report, especially in CIEG after the year and in our new strategic plan, Skills for a Changing World, we'd like to be able to translate and communicate what we have achieved in CPPs, and I know that's challenging because we're in 32 of them and they're run and led and delivered in different ways, but I think moving to a kind of more outcome-based accountability model is important for us and CPPs going forward, in line with the original intention of the Act itself around community empowerment. We can see real opportunities to make it clearer quantitatively where there has been results achieved. But I think it's like all things where there's a programme of work, there's a project, and then that's completed, and then we move on to the next focus because there is a lot of focus and priorities and ensuring we use people's time across the partnership effectively to deliver on those priorities, but making sure we actually build in the time to assess whether those priorities and the way we handled them, the solutions we designed with the community at the heart of that thinking, actually had the desired outcome that us as partners wanted to see. I think that's a space we would all like to kind of grow more into, especially SDS, in terms of our impact and making sure we maximise our role strategically as an organisation, nationally and locally. We are in a very privileged position where our role is essentially preventative, building resilience in communities in terms of career advice and skills support, employer-led skills support in particular. So I would particularly welcome a much more focus and maybe space to look at how we can capture outcomes more in the future.
Thank you for that, Sharon. Derek, do you want to add in further?
Yes, thank you very much. So I think we as an organisation can point to, on a case-by-case basis, where there's been certain impacts or outcomes from the input and involvement we've got with CPPs, but I don't think it's consistent in terms of having a framework across all of the 32 CPP boards in terms of actually what it is, going back to the LOIPS, what it is that the outcomes we're looking to achieve, the accountability for different partners in terms of delivering on those ambitions, and then crucially, how do we measure the impact? I don't think we have a consistent framework in place to allow us to assess that, other than on a kind of case by case, almost project by project basis. And I'm going to go back to my earlier point in terms of the SE's role in terms of economic development, job creation. That then brings it even down a level in terms of our input and delivery of particular activity and the outcomes and the measuring the outcomes and the impact of that. So I think there would be benefit of looking at potentially how we can have a more consistent and perhaps streamlined approach to measuring impacts and outcomes, particularly around the LOIPS.
Sure. I don't know, Karen, are you wanting to come in?
So I think it's really important to recognise the long-term nature of what community planning partnerships are about, so that generational return that I think other members of other panels have highlighted. There's sometimes a risk we're reporting on process rather than on the actual impact. I'm really keen, as others have highlighted, to explore the outcome that that the community planning partnerships are having. I think we've got lots of data, but we don't already always have the right sort of data. And there's a question about the so what of that data. So in rural areas, you'll have heard that postcode data can hide deprivation because the postcode areas are so large in rural areas. So it's really getting behind what the data means. For me, there's something really powerful about case studies and telling stories, and numbers hide some of that. Though some of the projects we've been involved in, the job numbers might be very small, but it has real impact on the community, on the resilience of the community, of creating spaces, of creating houses, of creating that opportunity piece. And a number just doesn't tell you that. So I think we need to, I think Mark McAteer in your previous session was focusing on that storytelling piece. Again, looking at some of the work that Scottish Government's doing as part of their regional policy review, they've been highlighting the importance of intelligence hubs. So bringing organisations together in regions to really get behind the data. And rather than, I think Derek was highlighting, rather than doing it lots and lots of times, we do it once and we do it well. So there's an opportunity there. I think there's also something in community planning partnerships about relationships. So one of the real impacts there is that trust and how organisations really understand each other in a different way. And again, that's not a number-based thing that you can measure.
Thanks, Karen. I think that's me. Convener, I'll hand it back to you.
Thanks very much, Marie. As always, very interesting piece around the challenges of the data and the importance of it. I'm going to pick up the theme culture, the culture of the public bodies, and I'm going to combine two questions. I think I'll start with Derek, so you know it's coming. So as a statutory partner, be interested to hear how do CPPs operate in practice at a local level? Have you noticed if there's anything that's changed since the 2015 Act? And also with your experience of working across CPPs, what in your view makes for successful community planning? So work in practice, has it changed, and successful community planning?
Thanks, Convener, for those questions. So I think what we have seen since 2015 is partners coming together and being aware of what those partners and those organisations actually do in terms of their role. So building relationships, I think, has been key since 2015, and I think we've seen greater collaboration, greater knowledge sharing, greater intelligence across partners as well as local organisations as well, which I think has been hugely beneficial. I think in terms of what's been successful has been those relationships, the ability to share data, to share insight, how we use that data intelligence then to build out actually what the priorities are at a local level, and engaging with community organisations to get their input into the issues, the challenges and also the opportunities, and then collectively working together to develop plans on how we can take action forward, I think has been important. So I think for me and for Scottish Enterprise, the success and the change from 2015 is that ability to bring partners, organisations, community organisations together and share information, share knowledge and build those relationships. And that probably, certainly within Scottish Enterprise, maybe we didn't have to the extent we have now.
Thanks very much for that. It's clear that relationships, that trust building is so important. Ian, I'd be interested to hear from you about those three questions.
Yeah, I agree that relationships are absolutely fundamental. I think there are good examples in the Highlands and Islands of CPPs that work because they have an effective leadership structure, but also that they have an effective leadership structure that doesn't stand or fall on individual personalities. I think that's really, really important. And also we find that horizontal integration is sometimes easier than vertical integration, which sounds a bit counterintuitive, but I think we've been very good, possibly across Scotland, certainly in the Highlands and Islands, at the kind of collaborative integration, that horizontal integration. Where we have found more challenges has been that vertical, moving from senior leadership to thematic to area geography based. I think that continues to be an issue for a number of our CPPs, partially based on size, partially based on geographic location, but it's a work in progress.
Thanks very much for that insight. And Karen, what about in the south of Scotland?
So we've seen less of that time period, obviously, because we've been a much newer organisation. And we came into effect a week after the first lockdown. So our experience of working with colleagues has been online. But I think that really cemented some strong relationships right from the beginning. So we came into a global pandemic that obviously nobody had experienced before and nobody was expecting. But it had it made sure that we were really focused on one thing. And that was making sure that our communities and businesses were able to survive through unprecedented circumstances. So it cemented us so as South Scotland Enterprise, our two local authorities, Visit Scotland and Skills Development Scotland, we created Team South of Scotland, and we're still meeting weekly just to do that really clear, focused discussion about, well, what needs to be done. At the beginning, we were focused very much on getting money out the door to businesses and community groups, but that has cemented and built really trusting relationships, which I think has stood us in good stead as we move forward. It's also enabled us to explore jointly funded projects, so working with partners, including third sector and development trusts, look at how we might come together to fund projects. Now, whether that's formally badged as community planning, I'm not sure, but it's certainly a good demonstration of that partnership working.
Thank you very much for that response. And now, Skills Development Scotland, Dave, I think you want to come in, and then Sharon.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, I've been quite lucky that I've sat in 10 different CPPs in my time with STS, but even speaking to colleagues, CPPs are different across the country. Now, they need to be slightly to serve the communities that they're responsible to, but there's got to be some consistency to support that. And I think in the previous panel you had, they were talking about leadership. Now, our CPPs have got strong leadership, but it's how we share that leadership across partners. Now, it was quite hard for our national organisations because we haven't got the resource to support around the administration, and that's usually down to the local authorities. But I do think there's something there about sharing that leadership across, but that also helps to build the relationships online. But we do need to help with some of that consistency of messaging and maybe structure to make it consistent across the 32 CPPs. But we still need that nuance to make sure that it's serving the communities that they're responsible to.
Thanks very much for that. Yes, it's a bit of a balancing act, isn't it, there, that nuanced approach, but also that consistency. Sharon, you wanted to come in.
Yes, thanks, convener. I just wanted to come in off the back of many points, actually, but I think for us, in terms of that kind of critical recipe for success, you know, looking at the very complex and challenging role we have around balancing the partnership and the participation, that is very challenging. I do think that where they work very well, it's around an ethical commitment to those communities still that experience poor outcomes or do at any one time. I also think there's a collaborative culture that needs to be formed, and you can see that in quite a few CPPs. I do think there's also a kind of leadership that's more facilitative, and I know that's come through in your feedback and it came through this morning, which is around bringing organisations together and understanding what organisations can actually do and can't around a particular priority. And even thinking of the kind of different shapes and sizes and nuances, there's also opportunity, you know, at this stage around looking at what those guiding principles are. Because when you talk about culture, that's something that needs to be constantly focused on, supported, and it's back to the roots of why we're actually here and what we've set out to do. And so something like a charter or some guiding principles, I think, would really help bring, not for a one-size-fit-all, but bring the learning of how others are operating and helping each of them become more effective. Thank you.
Thanks for that. Of course, that would come from Skills Development Scotland, right? We all got to develop our skills there. I'm now going to move on to the theme of local leadership and bring in Willie Coffey for that.
Thanks very much, convener, and hello to everyone. It kind of leads us nicely into this question about broader issues about leadership. And you'll be aware, of course, since the Act came into force in 2015, we would expect and hope that we see more examples of shared leadership within the community planning partners, and several of you have talked about that, and so did the previous panel. Is that your experience? Is it broadening out, or do you see it still largely still sitting, the leadership role still sitting within the local authorities? I can maybe start with Ian, because you made some comments earlier that were quite appropriate, I think, Ian. So over to you, Ian.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Yeah, really important, and my experience and our experience in the Highlands and Islands is that it is not led or seen to be led by local authorities. I think some of the measures that are in place in terms of the chair of the CPP rotating on a regular basis between partners helps that. That sense of shared leadership is inherent in that. Also, I'll come back to a Highland Community Planning Partnership level. It's really important that there's local leadership on the ground as well. And I think we've been quite lucky in that we've managed to not only find good, clear leadership, but that we've been able to combine that with our aspirations to bring the third sector in where we can. So relationship building has been particularly good. Our co-chairing during COVID with the third sector, I think, stood us in really good stead for where we are now. And on a wider Highland and other CPPs in the Highlands and Islands level, I think we are, looking back to where we were in 2015, we are in a much, much better place.
Thank you, Ian. I wonder, Derek, Scottish Enterprise, could you offer a perspective on that issue?
Yeah, so I think each of the CPPs and authorities are different. I do think, by and large, our experience on the CPPs and the subgroups to which we are involved, the leadership has tended to come from local authorities. So I think, going back to Ian's point, where there's an opportunity for that shared leadership, I think, is to be welcome. I do think we need to recognise the strengths of the individual partners to the CPPs and what value they can actually bring, and also recognise actually in areas of activity where we can actually add value. So I think that goes right up to kind of the leadership as well. But I think a more shared leadership approach is to be welcome, ensuring that partners on the ground at the local level have the ability to shape and influence the future direction of CPPs is a good thing.
Thanks, Derek. Maybe a comment from you, Dave, on behalf of Skills Development Scotland.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I agree. I think it's mixed. There's some areas where it is shared leadership, but it, from my experience, it's mainly local authority. But where I do see shared leadership is the local authorities have community planning officer groups, where the key lead officers, if you like, from the local authority and partners come together to help set the agenda for CPPs. I've seen that be 6-monthly rotations of leadership from the various organisations. But I do think going forward, it's something that we do need to try and do, is make sure that there's that shared responsibility in the leadership of the CPP. But it is challenging as well to support the resourcing of the minutes, the agendas, organising, etc. And that usually comes back to the local authorities. Maybe there's a different way to look at that, but that always comes back to the local authorities. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. And maybe lastly, Karen, on behalf of South of Scotland Enterprise.
Thanks. So I think similar to others, we see different organisations picking up on different themes. So some good examples of the third sector leading around digital exclusion, for example. Excuse me. So where they have a strong interest and strong expertise and perspective, they tend to lead there. In the borders, the police were leading on a good place to grow up, live it, live in, and enjoy a full life. And it was really interesting to see the reaction to the police leading that theme, because it got them into just transition and climate change issues, but a real demonstration of how committed they were as an organisation to the process for community planning, that they picked up on that priority. And I think that mixing of people leading different themes is really important. I also think it's really important that that leadership works throughout the organisation, though not just at board councillor level, but through officers and officials as well. And that's what makes it real. So you have the commitment at high level, but it filters through organisations as well.
Thank you for that, Karen. My last question, really, I'll probably do it in reverse order. Section 16 of the Act actually imposes a duty on the Scottish Government to actually promote community planning. In your view, what extent is that happening in practice? Do we see things, for example, like ministerial guidance and letters? Do we see budget decisions directing community planning? Do we see national strategies and so on? So it's a kind of top-down leadership question, I suppose, I'm asking. I might as well start with you, Karen, seeing as you're currently on screen.
Thank you for that. So obviously we've had a slightly different experience of guidance letters with a real focus on COVID and responding to the pandemic. But our last guidance letter absolutely picked up on that partnership working piece. So a focus on collaboration and a focus on really driving forward our regional economic partnership. So words from government coming through there. I think the National Strategy for Economic Transformation puts us in a good place around that collaboration piece. So themes there that I think, as others have highlighted, we can't do it alone. We have to work with others. So we see that focus from government on collaboration and on partnership. And their review of regional policy, again, puts us into that same place.
OK, thank you. Maybe Sharon from Skills Development Scotland this time.
Yes, thank you. Very similar to Karen, actually, in terms of our guidance. It's very strong on collaboration, partnership working, locality planning and national outcomes. So a really good fit for us. We've also got a focus through the new kind of careers design with the ecosystem. So that's us working very collaboratively and integrated with other agencies, colleges, universities, and training providers, the whole careers eco landscape together. And to oversee that, we will be supporting the career services. So it couldn't be more the topic of today in terms of collaboration and Scottish Government's promotion and support of that, and including my own interface with Scottish Government sponsor team, which I do updates on partnership working EPPs and how we're really integrated with partners to maximise our role and our impact. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon. Derek, on the issue about the duty to promote community planning from government level, are you seeing that in practice?
Yeah, absolutely. And I would just echo the points that Karen made there. So in terms of our guidance letters from Scottish Government, they always emphasise the importance of partnership working on collaboration, stakeholders and partners, aligned with national and regional strategies and at local level as well, recognising, you know, that actually being connected with partners and stakeholders, the sum of the whole is greater than the sum of the individual parts. So absolutely, in terms of our guidance letters from SG, managing partnership and collaboration working. Yes.
Thanks very much, Derek. And lastly, Ian, from your perspective in the Highlands, same question.
Yes, I'm going to say very briefly what everybody else has said, and just to add to that it's similarly reflected from our chairman and our board, so it does come down through the organisation as well, which is good to see.
Okay, many thanks, everybody. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Willie, and that concludes our questions for today. And I just want to thank you all for joining us online and giving your time so that we could understand more fully your perspectives of community planning partnerships. So thanks for that. We're now going to move on to the next item. The next item on our agenda for today is consideration of the following negative instruments. And there's a few of them, so bear with me. Non-domestic rates, restriction of relief, Scotland Regulations 2023, SSI 2023/28. Non-domestic rates, Scotland Order 2023, SSI 2023/29. Non-domestic rates, levying and miscellaneous amendment, Scotland Regulations 2023, SSI 2023/30. Non-domestic rates, transitional relief, Scotland Regulations 2023, SSI 2023/31. Council tax exemption dwellings, Scotland Amendment Order 2023, SSI 2023/36. There are no requirements for the committee to take any recommendations on negative instruments. Do any members have any comments on the instruments? Nobody has any comments. Is the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instruments? We're all agreed. Thank you. We agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next two items in private, so as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of our meeting.